All right, here we go. We have one of the great artists of our generation right now, who not only sold millions and millions and millions of records, but is responsible for bringing electricity to millions of Africans.
Right.
And like I've said before, someone who I feel will be remembered more for their humanitarian work than all the incredible music that they've dropped. Man, Akon, we go back 15 years.
Right.
Always a pleasure when we sit down.
Man, it really is.
Yes, sir. Well, we've done a lot of interviews over the years, but we've never done a real extensive sit down.
Right.
So I want to get into the whole Akon story from the very beginning. So you were actually born in Senegal.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, were you born in Senegal or in the U.S.?
Well, this is how it is. Well, my dad made sure that all of us was in the States. He made sure we was all born in the States so we have our citizenship.
Aha.
So shortly after birth, we all got shipped back to Africa. Aha. And then we was raised there until around 7, 8. And then we came back to the U.S. and then continued grammar school in the States into high school after that. But then every summer, we'd go back home. Like literally every summer until I graduated from high school.
Okay, so what was the experience like initially in Senegal?
Oh man, the experience there was actually, it almost felt like it was like stress-free. You know, you're surrounded by family.
Yeah.
Obviously I was a kid, so there was no bills, responsibility to worry about, but you was always surrounded by people that love you. You know what I'm saying? Everything in Africa is pretty much family orientated. That's why we're so close now as family members, me and my brothers and everybody. It was totally different environment, you know? The food there was fresh.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you was raised by the community, the neighborhood, the village. So everybody felt like family, you know what I'm saying? Only difference is, of course, at that age, I didn't really know what amenities were, you know, because we didn't really have sinks. We drank out of well water, cooked from the well water, bathed from the well water. Drank from the well water. You know what I'm saying? Yep. Everything was well water. And then as far as heat and electricity, it was bonfires, kerosene lamps, candles, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah, I've actually spent a few weeks in Dakar, right, in Senegal, and I lived with a family out there.
Mm-hmm.
And I could tell you the one thing that was so profound about my experience out there, because, you know, although I was born in Russia, I grew up in the U.S., and growing up in the U.S. as a white kid around black people, there's always a certain tension I've always noticed.
Right.
You know, like me and a black man that I don't know would walk by the street and we look at each other and there's a little bit of apprehension and so forth.
Right, right.
And I just figured, well, I guess just inherently blacks and whites don't trust each other or whatever else, until I went to Senegal. And when I went out there and I'm walking around and Senegalese meet me and they say hello, and there's like this level of, there's this lack of tension,
right,
and this level of friendliness.
It's acceptance all
the way. And it's suddenly, it just blew my mind where I just realized that, yo, like, racism isn't just something that's just natural. It's something because of the U.S.
Right.
And the history of slavery.
Right.
And all the horrific things that black people went through.
Right.
But when you go to Africa, where these people are at home.
Right.
They haven't been torn out of their homes and had their last names changed and forgot about their, you know,
yeah,
got their history erased.
It's a different perspective.
Yeah.
You know, towards white folks there, because it's kind of weird, because they actually was taken from there and brought here.
Yeah.
And then when they got here, they experienced what they experienced.
Mm-hmm.
But they never really experienced that in Africa. Like, in other words, it's kind of weird, because in Africa, the slavery you wasn't a slave in Africa. You was a slave when you left Africa.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Whereas later down the line, I think, you know, hundreds of years later, where they became these civil wars and, you know, neighboring countries coming in and take resources that create these wars amongst tribes. That's when the apartheid and all this other stuff start coming about.
Mm-hmm.
You know, whereas the whole divide and conquer issues that went on in Africa, that's probably the most they ever experienced when it comes to relations with white folks there. You know,
right,
what I mean?
Because Senegal was a French colony.
Right.
Right.
It still is, practically.
Oh, really?
I mean, yeah, you can say it ain't, but it's still controlled. I mean,
they still sell French bread, and they have
still,
like little French
still
flags.
Still spending French money. As long as you're spending French money, you're
so
being
you spend French money in Senegal.
Yeah, the CFA is made by the French.
Aha.
Which, mind you now, you can't spend that money in France. It's not worth anything.
Oh, wow.
Ain't that fucked up?
That's fucked up.
Right. So that was one of the reasons why I decided to start Ecoin, so we can have our own currency there.
And I want to talk about that.
Right.
But the one thing in Senegal, when it comes to slavery, is the island of Gorée.
Gorée Island, yeah.
Gorée Island. One of the saddest places I've ever been to.
That's, no, man, listen.
I cried when I was
there. I don't
think
there's no one that ever walked out of there with dry eyes. Like, when you hear the stories that happened on that island, the descendants from that island, the history of how that island came about, how they used to gather all the slaves and ship them from that point and that door of no return. It's, yeah. I mean, it's a powerful, I mean, you can still feel the energy when you go into those bunkers. Like, it's crazy.
Yeah, it basically was the slave distribution center of right. West Africa. Right. All the slaves would go and get put in these cages,
right.
essentially, and they would have cannons that surround it just right. in case someone wanted to steal those slaves.
Right.
And then all the boats right. from around the world, from Europe, would go to this island.
Pick up.
Right. Thousands of slaves, and then take them to America, Jamaica, right. South America, wherever.
Yes, it was deep. It was two ports like that. It was one in Senegal, and then they would go from there straight to Ghana.
Uh-huh.
Ghana also has the same type of bunkers, and then from there they go straight into Europe. Senegal was a starting point.
Isn't it just crazy in 2020 that people actually did this? Like, they actually just treated human beings yeah. like they were cows. Or goats and
no, it's crazy. I can't even fathom the thought of it, honestly.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
That's crazy, man.
How do Senegalese really feel about slavery and what happened? Because, you know, there were a lot of very foul people involved in the right. slave trade. There was, of course, Europeans, you right. know, Jews and whites were involved, but right. you know, Africans were involved in it right. as well. They were absolutely. Selling off their enemies,
right.
you know, the enemy tribes and making their money and so forth. Like right. how was slavery really looked at? Out there?
Well, in Senegal, we've kind of overcome the thought of slavery. We don't even think about it. The only time we think about it, honestly, is when we're doing tours that go to island. You know, outside of that, people have lived and moved and way beyond the slavery concept and idea and mind state.
Right, because in Senegal, you actually know your history. You
right.
can trace your family back 100 generations,
yep.
whatever else. You still have your names.
Right.
Your real names. You're right. not named Johnson.
Right,
or
and Jackson.
Jackson and Washington. And
Luther.
And all the other slave owners that were
right.
the presidents who had slaves during that time.
Right,
Jefferson.
Right. You know.
And so forth. Yeah, but you guys actually have your history. And that was the whole thing of walking around Senegal. People just felt, this was the first time I felt Black people just felt comfortable.
Right.
And with no type of disease. You right. know, I mean.
I think it's also the art of just letting the past go.
Yeah.
And moving towards the future. And I think in the U.S., they have this stigma of just not letting go of the past and blaming the past on every mishap or, you know, disappointment. And I think as long as you hold on to that past, it's just a lot of weight that you carry with you everywhere you go. And it's hard to move forward and move fast when you got a, you know, weight on your back.
Right.
You just got to let it go.
There's also been no reparations. And there's been, you know.
Yeah, but unfortunately, man, like, it's not like America is going to take the initiative to do it. I mean, otherwise they would have did it already,
yep.
you know? Indians got reparations. The Jewish got reparations for Holocaust, and it wasn't even done in America.
Yeah, that's true.
You know what I'm saying?
Italians got reparations.
Italians got reparations.
Japanese.
I mean, Japanese got reparations.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, it's to the point now where African Americans have to really understand their worth and realize that America was never or intended to ever, you know, consult or even make up for any of that. They're not sorry. They don't care.
Yeah.
It's obvious. So do you want to stay here and continue to be treated this way or just go back home where you're not no longer the minority? You actually are the majority and you control
yeah.
your destiny and your future and your land.
Yeah, no. Honestly, every Black person who has an issue with how people are treated in America, they really should go to Africa.
They need to. They just need to go.
99% of them have not.
I've never been there.
Yeah.
And they're super afraid to yeah. go.
A
like,
few of my friends, you know, the Michael Jai Whites have gone back. And,
right.
you know, the John Sallys have gone back. The people with money, you
right.
know, and means. But the average Black person in America has no idea how dope Africa really is.
I'm telling you, man.
Yeah.
They have no idea.
Yeah.
But I mean, you know, America did a great job brainwashing America.
True.
Because I'm telling you, the moment you mention Africa, they start shaking.
Yeah,
they don't even know why.
Think there's just tigers
just
jumping
fear.
Into your hotel
right.
room. And zebra attacks and
right.
the whole nine.
And the
yeah.
potential there is so ridiculous, man, if they yeah. all just went back.
So then at, what, 7 years old, you moved back to the U.S.?
Yeah, moved back to the U.S. Went to grammar school there in St. Louis, Missouri. Was living in U City and between U City and East St. Louis. Because my dad was working over at SIU. So I was like back and forth between, like I do my school during school hours in U City, then after school, go straight to East St. Louis. So I was always, East St. Louis was like probably the most craziest, ghettoest place I've ever seen in my life. Because at the time when I was coming up there, it was so bad around there that I remember when the police went on strike for 30 days.
Wow.
Can you imagine a place so bad that the police go on strike for 30 days? Because they just feel like we're not risking our lives for what y'all trying to pay. It's like, this is crazy.
So just all hell broke
loose. It was that bad.
At that point.
It was that bad, you know?
Okay. Because I've always associated you with Jersey City.
Right. So
that came later?
That came later. Jersey City came later. You know, so after Jersey City, my dad went to Miami for about 2 years. And then from there, we went straight to Jersey City. And Jersey City is where I started actually from high school. It was from ninth grade where I went to Jersey City. And Jersey City was a little different because that's when, you know, you got that transition between being a boy to a man and starting to really understand life for what it really is at that age where you start to comprehend what's going on around you. So that's why Jersey City was given so much credit at that time, because Jersey was really where I learned to understand me as a person and just became who I was. You know what I mean?
Right, because I guess your parents moved to Atlanta at one point and left you and your brothers in Jersey City.
Yeah, they just, Pops took the job and he came and we was in Jersey together for about 2 years. Around 10th grade, he got offered a job in Atlanta. Mm-hmm. So he took moms and went to Atlanta and said, listen, you guys have a choice. You know, you guys are adults. You can stay here or you can go with us to Atlanta and continue schooling there. Me and my brother Muhammad was like, we'll stay here. So we had this big ass 3-story house right on Kennedy Boulevard. Hmm. And they just left us and just allowed us to, you know, be who we was. Went to school or not. And we just, man, it was probably the best 2 years of my life.
You're saying that now.
Right, I'm saying that now when I go back, like, man, we had a popping parties all the time. But it was crazy. It was super crazy. But we was living out in the Heights. Out there, just all Puerto Ricans. Mm-hmm. And then up on the hill, where it's more niggas. That's where the niggas was in the hill, you know, up in the hill. And then up in the Heights was all Puerto Ricans. So I was living in the Heights. So I was raised by more Puerto Ricans than blacks when I was in Jersey. Because ultimately, it seemed like it was just a different feeling. And then the Latin culture was more closer to me at that moment because of my African roots and everything. We had so much in common. Whereas when I was, you know, in the hood, it was a little different because I was always the blackest one there. And at that time, black wasn't really in style. So, you know, they'd be joning on you, cracking jokes just for being black. You know what I'm saying? Like, it was just different.
By other black people.
Yeah, because they're not understanding. And the fact that I was African, I already seemed foreign to them. So the only ones that accepted me really in that area was the Haitians. You know what I'm saying?
Who were also dark,
was probably going through the same thing at that time. Yeah. So, you know, it was kind of weird, but it was an adjustment point for me.
How was as an African kid being made fun of by other black people? For your skin color, even though you're the same as them.
Right. It was the most confusing thing, but it was frustrating a lot too. And this is why I think what got me into fighting a lot. And then, because I got to the point where I just felt like every time somebody joned on me, I felt disrespected. So I just hook off all the time to the point where they just thought that, okay, this little nigga crazy. And they would dare any new school, like a new student that would come in, they would literally dare him because they just know I was going to react. And then my English wasn't that good either.
Right, because you spoke French?
Right. When I first came to the States, I spoke French, Spanish, Wolof, and was learning English. Mm-hmm. So my biggest thing was because I had such a deep accent, I didn't want nobody to know that I was foreign. So I kind of just focused on learning English with no accent. You know?
But you pulled off. Because usually, I was 4 when I came over.
Right.
So I don't have an accent. But my cousins, which are around your age, all have accents.
Right.
But you have no accent, which is pretty amazing.
Man, that was the focus, though. Like, I literally focused on it to the point where I didn't speak no French, pretty much no, because in the Midwest, there was nobody Spanish there. So I didn't speak Spanish or try to speak Spanish again until I got to Jersey. Mm-hmm. And by that time, I had lost most of it, like practically all of it, because I had nobody to speak with.
Mm-hmm. Well, at one point, you started dabbling in crime.
Right.
How old were you when you first started doing that?
All that started in Jersey.
Jersey City.
Yeah, all that started in Jersey.
Which is the car theft capital of the world, pretty much.
Yeah, all that started in Jersey. So because I was fighting a lot in Jersey because of the, you know, joning and disrespect, naturally, when you're known for fighting, you get accepted by a certain crowd, right? So at that moment, that's when the hood kind of slowly accepted me. And then I started making some real friends around that time. But in the process of all that, you get introduced to all the shit that's going on in the hood too, you know? So I tried my little weed selling. I didn't really like it, didn't make much money.
Right.
Then I saw the little crack vials and figured out what that was. To me, it was just all trading. I didn't even know it was a crime at the time, you know? But then I was like, damn, my homie just got locked up. He's doing 10, 15 years. And I'm like, damn, for selling that shit? So I'm like, nah. That shit don't add up. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And the homies that was like the kingpins, them niggas was doing life in prison, getting caught with more than 2-3 bricks. At that point, I was like, nah, this is definitely not it, right? So then I got hip to the car theft stuff, because I was working at a barbershop out in Newark. And out there, niggas would be just kind of rolling around. Every time you see them, they come in new different cars. And one of my homies came, he's like, yo, man, you know, you should get into this. This is some good money in it. And I was like, well, how much you making? He said, man, shit, I'm making like $40,000-$50,000 a week. And at that time, I was like, what? I said, but what do you do? He said, nothing. We just jack these cars, toss them to my man. He gets himself off with a poppy. Good. All we got to do is get the cars and bring it in. That's it. Pop and deliver. Done. And they give you $10,000 a joint. And I was like, nigga, let's do it. So now at this time, I'm kind of learning. You know, I ride in the shotgun. We go get a car, take it back, and start learning the connection, understand how it was. But I wanted to get more curious, so I started to understand. Once we drop it off, what happens? So it was a Jamaican guy that was actually owner of the shop, and I came after hours to go talk to him. At first, he was kind of paranoid because he wasn't quite sure if I was connected with the feds or whatever. He's like, why? Who just pops up on a nigga? Like, you know? So I was like, no, I just want to learn more about it, you know, see, understand how this shit works. So after a while, he kind of learned my trust and he kind of showed me what was going on. Then he showed me the VIN numbers and everywhere that VIN numbers are. I didn't even know that there's over 130 places in a car where a VIN number exists.
Oh, wow. Right. 130. Over, so if you just scratch off the one on nothing. The dashboard, that's nothing.
That's nothing. That's just the most visible one that, yeah. You know, they always check because it's more, you know, convenient. And then, of course, the side of the doors. And man, they listen, like, for instance, the BMWs, them shits are engraved in the engine, like in literally engraved, you know? So I started understanding and learning all that, man. I was like, man, so then I got really into it. Then my pops called and was like, listen, you know, Atlanta's doing really, really well. I'm out here. There's a festival out here. The Olympics is coming. You should come out and visit. And I was like, all right, cool. At that time, I was making some really good money, you know, like $25,000, $30,000 a week. And then that's when I ran to Wyclef in the barbershop as I was cutting. And he like, yo, come by the studio. You know, my uncle, man, he put it together, crazy, you know, studio for us, and we got this group we're about to drop. So I would come by, and every time I came in a different car, pulling out, like, yo, what's up? And I was like, yeah, you're just trying to get to this money. He's like, nigga, you need to focus on the studio. I'll tell you, this is going to be your future. So I would come, I would write, I would produce, and then I leave, hit back the streets. And then one day I just made up my mind, I'm going to Atlanta. And I went to Atlanta. And Atlanta was like paradise. Nobody knew about these cars. Nobody knew about any of this, right? So I was like, oh, this is perfect. So at this point now, I was like, okay, cool. I ain't really got the instruments, so I gotta kind of put it all together. So I get to Atlanta, I start moving around, the malls. I mean, they got restaurants with luxury cars just lining up. And sure enough, I was like, oh, this is it. So then I went the old-fashioned way, you know, jacked a few cars. Then I was like, this shit is too complicated. And my heart wouldn't take it every time I pull a gun out on somebody to make them get out the car.
Oh, so you were actually doing armed robberies?
Yeah, because at that point, that was the only source.
Okay, so I assume you were just breaking the cars, the hot wiring.
Nah, too complicated. Why do all that when you could just get out?
give me the keys.
Right. Goodbye. So my philosophy was the quicker, the simpler, the better, right? So then after three or four of them, I just, like I told you, my heart just I feel so bad. It's to the point where the last car, I ended up I found the receipt. I looked in the glove compartment, saw the address on the car, and I just took the car back with the keys in the car.
Huh.
That's when I realized, I said, man, I got to find a cleaner way to do this. Then it hit me one day. I went to this restaurant, I had the shorty with me, and the valet took my car, pulled out. And I saw him going through this box and it was a whole bunch of keys. I said, nigga, that's it right there. So just get the key boxes, right? So that became the thing. So then, whenever he go off to get the car, I just find a key, just peel anyone. It didn't matter because I just wanted to get rid of him. Then I had so many cars parked up in like parking lots and like malls and apartment complexes. I had two of my homies that actually, one of them actually came in from Jersey named Just. You know, he became a part of the team, but then there was another one named Maul. He was actually out of Philly. Now he was the OG of this car stuff. He taught me stuff that I didn't even know existed. Like, but once we all kind of connected, it became like a union. And then we started peeling keys where we would go to dealerships because niggas wanted sometimes they wanted cars brand new. We called it peeling keys. We'd go peeling. We'd go to the dealership and just test drive a car and never come back. Right? You know? Right? Things like that. Or we'd walk through the dealership and sometimes dealers had a key just sitting on the table. Like they just have it sitting on the table.
Just drive off.
Yep. The car. Just peel it. Go outside. Hit the doo-doo. That's the one. Jump in. Pull out. So it was super easy. Then I created the operation where it was like, I can tell now because I'm no longer in it, but for those who are in it, you can't do it no more. The fares are all over the shit. So the crazy part, so now I will go to straight valets and be like, listen, I know you're moving these cars. Majority of these cars all got spare keys in them. So if you can find me a car with a spare key, hit me, I'll give you $500. All I want is the key and an envelope with the address on it. And it was like, cool. So then they started moving. I mean, I was getting so many spares. Late night after 12, I'll find the address, GPS over there, pick up the car, and ride out. So that became the new way. It's super easy. I ain't had to pull nobody out with no weapon or nothing. Like just my phone constantly going off. Yo, we got four keys today. We got five keys today. So I was like literally about maybe 25 cars a week just from the valet service. So then we had so many cars lined up, but people that we were selling these cars to kept getting stopped and then they'd get locked up. Mm-hmm. But what I realized was none of them did major time because if you actually had the keys to the car, it would just be a plain joyriding charge, which was a misdemeanor.
Ah, okay.
Right. So I was like, man, this is the business. I'm selling each car for about $20,000-$25,000 a piece, right? And if you get stopped, you just get a misdemeanor charge and get a slap on the wrist. You can't beat that. Well, these niggas is taking like penitentiary chances with these drugs. You got to worry about a nigga coming robbing you, kicking your door in. You know, false deal where they are, wasn't planning on buying it at all, was just going to try to take it from you. You got risk of getting shot, getting killed, all this for $5,000 profit. It didn't really make sense, but this actually made sense to me. But then I said, okay, we got to make this operation all the way bulletproof. Then I had to figure out, okay, let's get insurance for these cars, right?
So you're getting insurance on stolen cars.
Right, right, okay. Right. Now we have to find a DMV connect. So we can be able to get these cars registered. So that's what was the plan. You know, I go into the DMV, find the most insecure looking one. You know what I'm saying? Most of the time they'd be heavy set girls. You know, you flirt with them a little bit, take them out to eat. You know what I'm saying? Let them know what's going on. Listen, I'm gonna send you some numbers, get these registered, and I'm gonna hit you off $1,000 every time you register a car. At this point it was good because it was all clean numbers because it was from the dealership and not had been sold yet. So it all worked out. So with the money now, I created my chop shops. And I had three chop shops in Atlanta. I was bringing in so much money, at least probably $150,000, $175,000 a week, literally. But I couldn't bank this money because I didn't know how to justify it. And that's when I started taking the money and started creating, building out recording studios. So I had recording studios in Atlanta where niggas would just go in and do their demos for absolutely free because I needed to keep the studio constantly running.
So you're just laundering the money through the studio.
Right. And so at that time, studios was a cash business. Mm-hmm. So I created my entity and then the money that would get from the thing, I would put it into bank and just say it was from the studio. So whenever they would check, studio would constantly be busy, and I had like three of them. So it was so many artists that before they even had a demo out, would use my studios to actually do their demos. Because most of them ain't really had no money, it was all broke. So I just opened the studio for them to go in.
Well, before you go on, how did you get caught? How did you get locked
up? Okay, so, boy, unfortunately, see, I was a type nobody really never saw who I was. And I try to keep that cushion between me and the customer every time, you know. Now, my partners, Justin Maul, were totally different. They was out there. They was out in the scene. Everybody knew who they was. You wanted something, you know, you can go to them to get it. And they would be the type to rob you and say, yeah, I did it. Here's my location, come see me. Like, they was out there like that. So they was the front runners of the whole operation. So as they started moving around, clearly, you know, you sell, people start moving, and then somebody gets caught, and eventually, when you're under pressure, somebody's gonna tell. That's just what it was. Mm-hmm. Now, my two partners just, I would say, got a little too comfortable. because they was into any and everything at that point because they just had so much paper, right? They got into some stuff with some people that just wasn't as thorough as we was as a unit, and people just started talking, you know? So they end up picking Jamal up, picking Just up, and I was the last one to get picked up. So I'm riding down the highway one day, and I just see this helicopter flowing over me. At the moment, I ain't really, you know, think nothing of it. 2 days later, I'm coming out of my house, and I see a helicopter hovering. I'm like, damn, helicopters are everywhere. I must have raised the budget, you know, for security in the city or something, because I never really seen this many helicopters. 2 days later after that, I'm leaving the mall, and I see another helicopter. So now I'm like, this is 3 times in 1 week. This is not normal. So I'm riding, going off the exit, and some just said, make this right turn. So I go to make the right turn, but I was like, nah, let me make this left, because this is a lot faster to get there. And why when I made that left, I promise you on everything I love, the moment I turned that left to get on the highway, they just came from everywhere. Zoop, 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 zoop. Get on the floor, hands down, face down. I was like, oh yeah, what the fuck? You know the basic routine. Man, they locked my ass up, man. I'm sitting there, they interrogating me. And I'm actually in a stolen car at that moment.
Red-handed.
Red-handed, but it was all legit though. The VIN number was clean. The car was registered, had State Farm insurance, and they couldn't figure out how the hell he did this. So he was like, yo, you know, how do you do this? I said, what do you mean? I'm just a customer. I bought this car. It was used. Somebody sold it to me. They're like, nah, don't worry. We've been trailing you for a minute. We got plenty of surveillance. I said, I don't know what y'all surveilling on then, because I'm just hanging out. Then you must have saw who I bought it from if you was watching me. Go chase that nigga, because me and you, we're in the same position. So, of course, they'll try to get you to confess and tell on yourself. It never really happened. I go through 6 months of trial in the process of me being held in jail. And then I had a case in a gun charge in Burlington County with Just. So when I beat the case in Atlanta, they had to transfer me over to Burlington to beat that case. And then what happened was me and Jamal was driving over to Jersey, and we had guns in the car at the time when we got pulled over. So they tried to charge both of us with the weapon. And at that time, I didn't feel like it would have been fair for both of us to be charged for guns in the car that was already in there when Just was riding with me. He had one on him, but I made him keep his gun home because I already had weapons in the car. Mm-hmm. So when we got stopped, I ended up just taking the charge for the both of us. So when that happened, he was able to go home, but then they stuck me with that charge. And then I had some good attorneys who actually knew some of the judicial, you know, pieces over there, including the judge, and they were able to get me off on a 3-year probation with obviously a fine for driving with a weapon. And it was my first official offense as a felony, so they was able to give me a break, you know.
Right, because you did like 3 years combined?
Yeah, altogether. Yeah, combined together, it's about 3 years. And at that time, it was the perfect marketing plan for me, because I'm a marketeer on every front. Everybody thought, man, he did 3 years. I was like, yeah, I did 3 years. But I never told nobody how I did them 3 years. They were actually in pieces. Yeah. I just combined it all together. Now I can, you know, completely be upfront, but it was all a part of the strategy also to make my image believable too at the same time. Because, you know, at that time in hip hop, man, it was like you had to have some kind of track record. Even though my philosophy was never get caught. You got to be the smartest nigga out there. You can't be the dumbest and the loudest, right? So I kind of needed to be a little ignorant just for the sake of branding my music. But mentally, I was always ahead of the game and I always was tactical in everything I said or everything that I decided to make a decision on moving forward.
Well, you first showed up on the Fugees album?
Yeah. It was a record on the the Ooh La La remix, actually.
Right.
They called Mr. Martin, tell him to build a coffin. So that was around the time when I was working super heavy with the Fugees. I was part of the refugee camp. Mm-hmm. Me, Wonder, Spider, obviously, you know, Prize, Clef, and Lauren. And it was just like a bunch of foreigners. Like, we were all literally refugees around that time. And we was all based and fully, you know, like, focused on music to an extent. I was always the one that had one foot in, one foot out. But the rest of them all went in heavy. But it was the craziest thing, because as I was locked up, I was watching the Fugees just blowing up. Like, that'd be your biggest wake-up call. When you see the people that you coming up with, you watching them on TV, like getting it, and you stuck in the cell.
Yeah, and they really blew up.
And they really
the score. I mean, the first album didn't do that great. And I had interviewed, you know, Wyclef right. and Praz, and we talked about this in depth. That first album didn't sell nothing.
Right.
But that second album with the score went like diamond.
Man, like diamond.
Yeah.
Like, they actually, man, I think their music is what opened the door for even my records to come in a certain kind of way. You yeah. know what I mean? Because it was all from the same DNA. Because mm-hmm. me and Clef was always in competition. Like, always. But it was great. Healthy competition though. We'll look and we just know, okay, whatever you do, nigga, I'm coming right behind you. But it was always that's I think that's what fueled us, you know, to be who we are today. Like even to today, like when we did that big ass concert in Haiti, it was like we was literally outdoing each other on stage. I do one backflip, he do two. Then I do three, he do one with no hands. Then I jump on the fucking tree and started swinging on that. He jumped on the pole. Yeah. So, but it was like, it's like, You would have thought that me and Clef was born from the same mother and father, the way we move. Like, we're literally like brothers, you know? But he was always like more of a bigger brother kind of thing for me.
Okay, and at what point did you actually start doing music?
Music was always in my blood because my dad was always a musician. You know, every time he went from one college to the next, he was teaching music. All the way from SIU, you know, to Clark Atlanta, you know, University of Miami. That was always what he was doing. But he was more of a jazz musician and percussionist, you know? So ultimately the music was always in my blood. And whenever I was going through something, music would be the only thing that I actually could relate to talk. Cause I never really talked to anybody about what I was dealing with. Cause at that time, what I was dealing with wasn't quite legal enough to talk to just anybody about it. So I kind of kept a lot of information within myself, but I had to vent somehow. So music was the way I vented. So even with these little recording studios that I had, I would kind of go in when nobody was like kind of booked out and just kind of, it was almost like a diary to an extent, but through music. I would just make it quietly and just put it away in DATs and then play it in my car, wherever the case may be.
And were you always singing or did you start out rapping?
I started off doing rap, reggae. Nigga, I was doing everything. It wasn't nothing I wasn't doing.
Right, because you know, you talk about Wyclef and them and his. Yeah,
around that time it was all West Indian.
You don't really know
West
what he's
going
to do.
It was more West
genre
Indian.
Genre bending, yeah.
Yeah, at the time of the Fugees, around that time, I was doing more West Indian stuff. I was doing dub plates, you know, that's where I was into that then.
Yeah.
The rap really ain't go really hard until I moved to Atlanta.
Okay, and then you end up linking up with Divine Stevens.
Right.
And he was the one that brought you to SRC.
Right.
My old home.
Right, right.
So you end up getting signed to SRC, which was formerly Loud Records.
Yep.
And I remember hearing the story from around the office. You know, this was not the Akon, the superstar Akon that everyone got to know later on.
Right.
You know, rough around the edges. The style wasn't really developed.
Right.
And when you did Locked Up, they said you were on promo tour for a year and a half before that record
before
started to pick up.
Before that record pop.
That just goes to show
a whole year and
like
a half.
Steve Rifkin's visionary ability to put someone on the road for a year and a half on promo tour, which means you make no money. That means the label is spending thousands upon thousands.
Right.
But see, every week.
This the thing, like Steve, the reason why I respect him and love him so much today is because he fought for me. Mm-hmm. You know, Steve was one of those dudes, he kept it all the way 100 when he came and saw me in Atlanta. He said, listen, I don't really have that much money, but I'm gonna do everything in my power to help you get to where you're trying to go. He said, I know you're getting offers, because at that time we had like 4 or 5 different offers. He said, listen, I believe in you. He said, if you invest in anything else, invest in the one that believes in you, because he's going to give his all to make sure you get there. And I believed him when he said it. So me and Divine spoke about it, and we turned all the mother deals down and went with Steve. And our advance was only
$12,000.
$12,000. 12 grand. That was it.
Which you got to split with Divine?
Me and Divine split that half.
So you got 6 grand minus taxes?
After taxes and the bills that was already probably piled up.
You're already in the red.
Right, it was just an agreement.
The debut album comes out in 2004, Trouble.
Right.
And by this time, Locked Up was already a big single?
Not quite, because at that time, Universal wanted to go with a record called Belly Dancer, which was more of a pop record. Yeah. And then we were fighting to get Locked Up going, because they didn't quite believe in Locked Up. But Steve knew that record would be hit, but they wouldn't give him no budget to promote it because they wanted to focus on Belly Dancer. So I was like, yo, Steve, we need some money. Like, figure it out. Like, how are we gonna do it? He said, Khan, with all due respect, I want to, but the label just won't give me no budget for this. All the money's allocated to Belly Dancer. But look, I'm just gonna give you what I got and then you guys figure it out. So he wrote us a check for $10,000. And then Gabi, Cleve, God bless his soul, he passed away.
Yeah, rest in peace, Cleve.
Right? And Ike, it was me, Steve, I'm sorry, me, Gabi, Cleve, and Ike. And we rented this Yukon van and we just started rolling. every stop we stopped, we called Steve. And then we hit, Steve called one day, he said, yo man, I got this idea. I think it would be super dope and it's something that you probably can scale out if it actually works. But the general manager of Rikers Island reached out and he wants someone to come in and speak to the inmates. Mm. He said, I think this would be a good jail, the fact that you got a song called Locked Up. And you know, he's speaking. I said, you know what, that'd be dope. Let's do that. So we end up doing that. And we performed for the inmates, spoke to them. I gave them my experience and told them what was going on in my life and how I got to where I was. Man, it was such a huge impact that he ended up calling the facility in Philly and was like, listen, we manage Philly as well. Would you like doing that? We was like, hell yeah. But it was crazy because after that, we did about 4 or 5 of them and just kept going.
You had a prison tour.
It became like a prison tour.
Yeah.
And dude, the most amazing thing happened. This was actually after almost 7, 8, maybe 9 months of just going all over, just meeting DJs, paying out all the debts, because Steve had a lot of debts too, and a lot of DJs. Then he said, oh, mad niggas money. Steve was a hood nigga. Like,
Steve still owes me money.
Steve still owes me money.
I'm not going to collect, like, it's fine. Him. I got money now. Steve still owes me a few
right.
thousand, but whatever.
Steve was a straight gangster. He was just like, man, listen, fuck them niggas. Yep. So we had to pay some people off and shit. You'd be like, yeah, look, this is from Steve. He said, thank you, man, for all your support. But I was literally coming out of my pocket, but I just had to make sure we was all coming together because at that moment, we was all one team.
Well, and I got to say, since me and you go back, I could keep it 100 with you.
Right, right.
I was actually kind of disappointed over the Tekashi remake of
Why?
Of Locked Up.
You know what? It's funny you say that, Vlad, because a lot of people called and was like, they was upset. But I'm like, why? I would like to know why you were upset, though.
Well, here's the thing.
Right.
You've always been a guy that, even to this day, has been connected to the streets.
Right.
You're not just a suburban guy who has no idea about what's going on. Right. You've always had street guys around you.
Right.
You've been in that life. You've had people snitch on you.
Right.
And so forth. And with the Tekashi situation, this is someone who claims that he's a victim in this whole thing. Mm-hmm. But the reality of it, we followed the story very closely and I've right. interviewed people around him. He was essentially the ringleader of all this shit that was happening. He was putting hits out on people. He was getting people robbed. He was beefing with all these rappers and then having his crew go in and clean up all the disasters that he was making. Mm-hmm. And then when he got caught and he was facing 47 years himself, he told on everyone, gave out over 75 years with 2 people still awaiting life sentences. Mm-hmm. So when I heard that you're doing Locked Up, you know, I'm wondering what the chorus will be like. You know, I'm locked up, but they let me out. Now they're locked up, they let me out.
All right, so Vlad, see, this the interesting part about, now first let me ask you, have you had a chance to actually interview Tekashi?
No, I haven't. I met him one time very briefly.
Right. One thing I realize about life, and me being not only an artist, but someone that's famous, and I was successful detaching my fame from the street mm-hmm. early.
Yes.
Because I was around people that wanted to see me make it. I was around people that understood, okay, he's going to be what saves everybody else. So they were able to hold that fort down while I was able to become who I am to now pull them out the street, right? In the game, and you know better than anybody, everybody's going to play a role. Mm-hmm. Everybody has to have their position.
Yeah.
And when you have members that don't quite play their position, something is gonna fall off the west side. Something is gonna go wrong, something's gonna go bad. When that something goes wrong and that something goes bad, the responsibility as to what your role is determines who takes responsibility for that. if you are the star or you are the breadwinner, nigga, I don't give a fuck who or what. That needs to be protected. Mm-hmm. With a solid bulletproof vest, a fucking force shield, whatever, that right there needs to be protected. And you're going to do whatever it takes to make sure that's protected, because that's your only role. You don't have no other role outside of just protecting that, because that feeds everything over here.
Right.
Now, the rumors, which I can say are rumors, because there's always his story, your story, and then the truth.
Yeah.
You never really know. And I think with Tekashi, there's been a lot of speculation. And I want to be the one to say, you know what, bro? Ain't nobody going to say it out loud. Because if you're in a position where you have to justify who you are and what you are to the street, then you've been a poser since day one. Right?
Right.
Because think about it. No, just think about it. Okay. Think about it for a second, Vlad. Half the people that are upset aren't in the street. Never been in the street. They don't even live by the code of the street. Mm-hmm. Tekashi ain't snitch on you. Why are you mad? Just think about it. If I was in the mix with him and I was affected by him telling on whoever, or for whatever reason he told, that's what I don't like to talk about why he did it. I just know that for whatever reason he did it, he had his reasons. Now, if he comes out one day and says, I did it for this, this, that, that, and the reason, which he's done already, right? The question is whether or not you believe his story. See, it goes to a matter of who you decide to believe. Me, I don't give a fuck who did what. What I can tell you is that whole clique was super messy. Mm-hmm. Everybody was sloppy.
The 9 Trey Bloods.
Right?
Yep.
Everybody was sloppy, and everybody was trying to claim notoriety. Because real street niggas ain't doing shit that loud. Mm-hmm. They're not broadcasting shit they doing.
I agree.
They just not, my nigga.
I agree.
Right? But what I do know is 80% of that was entertainment. The other 20% was a real street nigga in there that did some shit for real. And the feds focused on that, right? Mm-hmm. And when they focused on that, they realized that, okay, that can't just be done by one person. That was done by a collaboratory group that all agreed that this needs to be done and let's do it.
I understand what you're saying.
Right.
And I respect what you're saying.
Right.
But when you talk about rumors, there's an actual videotape.
Okay.
Of Tekashi putting a hit out on Chief Keef and offering the shooter $20,000.
But you gotta also know that Tekashi was doing a lot of that just for views. And he was not solely doing that.
That actually happened though.
No.
They got shot at. Guy got paid off, and now he's doing more time than Tekashi did.
No, but listen, but
like, you see what I'm saying? That's selling you a kilo.
Honestly. if you go out like nigga, that gotta be the dumbest nigga I ever heard in my life or seen. Or nigga, that nigga's stupid, first of all. I'm not about to take no orders from a nigga in public and then execute that order. Who the fuck does that? And then you wanna blame this nigga? Nigga, you told on yourself when you went and did it.
Right, but
this nigga ordered it in public. You can clearly know that this shit ain't real. Who does, who orders a hit live on the internet? Really? You gotta know that's entertainment, my nigga. If you dumb enough to think that was real, and you go and try to execute that.
But he was actually paid off. That's the whole thing. Tekashi testified against the guy who had him do the hit. That'd be like me selling you a kilo of cocaine and saying, hey, I know this drug dealer named Akon.
Right.
I'm selling to him myself.
Okay.
Don't arrest him.
And then I see the video, and then I go accept the drugs from his ass, and I get popped.
Okay.
I'm the dumb one.
Yeah, man, listen.
Because you understand, the hit was made first. I mean, the request for the hit was made first. Then the nigga got paid, I think.
Believe he got
paid. Wait a minute.
Paid.
Well, first of all, I don't even know what the fuck happened. Right. Just scratch that, because I don't know what happened. I ain't going to lie. I don't know what the fuck happened. All I know is that if a nigga is out there publicly saying and doing this, y'all can't be that dumb to believe that real crimes are being discussed online and then real thugs are out executing these requests. Vlad, niggas can't be that stupid.
But it actually happened. That's the whole thing. There was actually a shooting.
But
nobody got hit.
But
there was an actual shooting. Maybe he didn't know. He wasn't filming it himself. There was other cameras around. That's the whole thing. He wasn't like all live talking about 20 grand to shoot at Chief Keef. There was actually cameras around, which you're not sure whether he sees
Vlad
or not.
Always look like they life, them niggas keep cameramen around them.
Yeah.
Like, you gotta understand, me knowing Tekashi the way I know him right now, and I don't know him for his past. Mm-hmm. I know him for what I think his potential is. I think he was just wrapped up in a situation that was way beyond what he understood the streets to be. In his mind, it's all entertainment. Ha ha, hee hee. But then he realized this shit just got real. And at the moment when it just got real, he realized also that the people that he felt was rocking with him wasn't quite rocking with him the way he expected them to rock with him. So he didn't feel in his mind that him giving his life was necessary for someone that wouldn't necessarily give their life back to him. That was his explanation to me, right? Now, as a man, I can tell you, bro, I've been around a lot of street niggas. Mm-hmm. Some who are considered to be the most elite that niggas make songs about today.
Yeah.
Right?
I've interviewed those guys.
Right.
Yeah.
And there's some niggas that's active right now that people don't really even know. Mm-hmm. Now, for those that's in that arena, they look back and laugh at this story. Literally laugh at this story. Because it's so many people that has opinions that honestly don't know the specifics of how that could even be possible if you're really in the street. This shit is, nigga, entertainment could be the only way that could even enter into the real lives of real niggas, man.
Listen, we're gonna have to agree to disagree on this one.
No, but it's
and,
okay.
And I respect you.
No,
and, you know, me and your honestly, friends, like, I fuck with you.
It's
you know,
honestly okay.
Because at the end of the day, listen, you and I have street guys around us.
Right.
We always have, right? I got jailed guys, I got street guys. If I go tell someone to go beat someone up or even shoot at somebody,
I can do that. For the right price, anybody
for the right price, it could be done. But at the end of the day, I'm not sitting there dissing people like YG.
And creating
beef with all these people and then telling my guys to go take care of my mess.
No, listen.
And then, when that gets out of hand, I'll go and tell on all of them for taking care of the mess that I started. You're not feeling me on this one? No?
It's because I don't think it went quite like that, right? But what I can say is, if the story went the way you said it, that would be fucked up. It would be. But
and it did, but go on.
No, but I'm just saying, if it did, because right now it's alleged, right? If it did, it would be fucked up. But on the second hand, everybody in the rap game today all claim to be street niggas or all claim to be connected to
certain type of rappers, yeah.
Right. First of all, who gives a fuck? None of us got into the street game to stay in that motherfucker. We all got in it because we had no other choice. That was our only way out, and that way we saw that we can feed our families, right? And as you can see, the moment our families was fed, nigga, we living in the fucking mountains, someplace far away from the hood.
Yep, gated communities and the whole.
Nigga, we out of it. Yep. Like that, we don't even care about that. That's like, but if we can give back and give niggas like that the opportunity to come out of the hood, we plan to and we would love to. And we continue to do as much as we can without it affecting us, right? Because their mentality gotta be all in the right place. But if you utilizing that to grow your business or to so-called inject that culture into what hip hop is known to today, because hip hop was built on battles. It was built on controversy. It was built on that back and forth. You know who did it the best and actually kept it that way and still doing it till the day, but nobody really hit him hard like that? It's 50 Cent. 50 is known for that. 50 builds on controversy.
Yeah.
Because he knows at the end of the day, it's entertainment. Now, if you take it differently and say, man, that's fucked up, I'm gonna see about this nigga. Oh yeah, he'll be prepared to see you. Cause that's what the game is.
Yeah.
You gotta hold your own.
Yep.
If I'm gonna have the guts to diss this nigga, I gotta be prepared for whatever comes back, right? That's hip hop, the street side of hip hop. But what people also don't realize is whether somebody loves you or hates you, and you send a video and you comment that I love it or I fucking hate it, it's still engagement. And it still generates millions of dollars when you start to get to the point where it's billions of engagements.
Yeah.
All Tekashi seeing, my nigga, is that engagement.
Yeah. I mean, he's doing well financially.
That's all he cares about.
Whatever he did, it works for him and he has to live with it.
But and, that's also the personal side of the business. And that's the street side that I think this is the reason why a lot of hip hop artists never can get to superstar status because they take things too personal, right? In this case, whatever Tekashi was dealing with his homies and his clique, that's between Tekashi and his clique. The fact that everybody's all emotional about it, honestly, is irrelevant because that's something they have to deal with amongst themselves. Them niggas wasn't raised the way we was raised. They don't understand that lifestyle. None of these little young niggas is loyal to nothing but that dollar today. They're not loyal to a principal or loyal to a family. They're not loyal to nothing but that dollar.
Yeah.
Period.
But it also sends the message out that, listen, you could go out and cause a bunch of chaos and, you know, basically overlook a bunch of crimes. And as long as you tell on everyone else, you could walk away from it.
Black, can I tell you something? In jail, 80% of the motherfuckers that's locked up right now are all cooperating with the police. There's more snitches in jail than there are so-called real niggas. Everybody in that motherfucker done cooperated. If they can get time less the amount they was given, they telling my nigga. You gotta know that walking in.
Have you told them anybody?
Never. I never had to. But
you could have.
Hell yeah, I could have.
Come on.
But listen.
You could have told on your partners, you could have told on your customers. You could have gotten zero time.
Vlad,
those 3 years you could have had living the life.
Vlad,
but you didn't do it.
All the way 100 real. My two homies, Jamal and Just, I know would never roll over on me. Ever. So I would never roll over on them. I took charges for them the same way they took charges for me. That is a principle I understood growing up. That's us.
Mm-hmm.
Us. If it was another nigga threatening my family, putting hits out on me, and he's supposed to be my homie, and the whole time he plotting behind me, and I find out later, on tape or whatever the case, nigga, fuck that nigga. I'll roll over on this nigga like shit because he ain't, who the fuck is him for me to respect? He don't respect me. There's no honor amongst thieves right there.
Mm-hmm.
Then the game is wide open. But if it's honor amongst thieves, y'all niggas got a code amongst y'all that nobody ever broke. And then you break that code like how the mob did, oh, that's to be talked about. But this generation ain't no code between these niggas. It ain't none over there, Vlad. What, nigga, that ain't, you can't respect a code that they don't respect.
Gotcha.
You just can't.
I feel you.
Now it's between your family and these slimy ass niggas. I'm not choosing those slimy ass niggas. I'm gonna keep it all the way 100.
So is that song coming out? Like on Tekashi's album?
It's definitely coming out. It's definitely
coming out. So it's done. You've completed it.
It's done, recorded, mixed, mastered,
right,
and it's gonna drop on his album.
Right.
And listen, in this case, I'm just a messenger.
Yep.
Don't shoot the messenger.
Right. And Styles P is not going to show up on it this time
around. No, me and Styles made a classic.
Yes.
Because me and
he
Styles
up on the
went
original.
Through the same thing.
Yeah.
Styles was locked up. I was locked up. There was a million other real niggas locked up in our generation. That song was for niggas in our generation.
Yeah.
This new locked up, that's this generation. This represents this new generation.
Okay.
And listen, this song was made for the people.
Yeah.
And if our generation has changed from a standard of ethics and street code, then that's cool. I'm just not a part of that. But I'm just like you in this case. I'm just broadcasting what's out there.
Mm-hmm. So let's get back to our regularly scheduled program here. I just want to touch up on the first album, Ghetto was actually my favorite song.
Right, right.
That was a classic. I thought that was the best song on the album.
Right.
I know it did well, no, but not like some ghetto songs. Man. But ghetto
was one of, it was a huge, and the beautiful part about it is that we made international remixes in different languages in every ghetto around the world, man. That record right there is just, I'm telling you, it's unmatchable. For sure.
Okay. So then after that, that's when you did Soul Survivor with Jeezy?
Yeah, Soul Survivor was done after that.
And that was your first like feature? On a rapper's, you know, doing the hook
first,
on a...
I want to say that was, actually.
It was a hell of a feature.
I think that was my... Yeah, that was my first... Because before then, I didn't really want to feature on nobody's records. I was actually more getting features for mine, but I would be real strategic as to doing it. But then that was... Jeezy was part of the fam, so it was I had to. And then he was in a position where he needed that extra little boost to give him that
and you got to understand, at that time, this was 2005.
This was 2005.
Jeezy was on fire.
Right.
That first album, you know, which is still considered his greatest album. Yeah, first the mixtape with Drama.
Right. That mixtape.
Yeah.
is actually what started, because I remember John put out a mixtape, and then he put out that fucking Thug Motivation, and DJ Nando, who was he was like one of the biggest strip club DJs at that time. The way he would play the whole album, like literally from top to bottom. and he'd do it on the nights when everybody was out.
Right.
So by the time, nigga, that summer was over, it was, you couldn't go anywhere and not hear Jeezy.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. No. And at the time, Jeezy was still affiliated with BMF.
Yeah, he was with the fam at the time.
Yeah, and I remember I got flown out to Atlanta to hang out with BMF.
And you already know how them niggas do.
Big Meech, yeah. I got to hang out at Big Meech's house, and that's when I met him. And Blue Da Vinci and everyone else.
Right, right.
That was such a crazy era.
Man, that era, honestly, I think fueled what you see today. Because before then, niggas was flossing, but not really.
Like BMF. BMF had billboards.
Them niggas,
BMF would spend $100,000
in a strip
club. Right,
them niggas disrespectful with it.
It was crazy.
Like, it was after BMF, and that's when every rapper had to feel like they had paper. They all had to feel like they had to rock big chains and do it up in the clubs.
Right, because BMF were selling BMF no albums started, and were doing
yeah,
all
they,
that.
They started, yeah. Before that, it was like everybody had their own style. Everybody was a little different. But when BMX came, they came and brought the lifestyle to it. Yeah. And I mean, they just overdid everything.
Yeah.
Every time.
Yeah.
So it was that era that made everybody feel like now they have to have a crazy car, have to, you know, spend mad money in the strip club. They got to rock a whole bunch of Jews. I mean, Jews was always in hip hop culture. But it was like the combination of all that pulled together.
Yeah. Well, I think later that year, that's when your manager got killed.
Yeah, Screw. Screw got passed.
Screw got killed. You were there?
I was actually there that day. Yeah.
Can you talk about that situation?
Yeah. I mean, it was because me and Capone was hanging out that whole week.
Yeah.
Capone at the time was working on some new records. He wanted to get some new things done. He was kind of finessing to try to get a feature. So we wanted him to come just hang out with us, you know, just get to know the fam, understand who I'm with and my crew and everything like that. So we took him to ringside. Like the whole week we hung out ringside. It was that Friday I was supposed to be heading off to the Bahamas for a show. And then we had that comedy corner that it was a comedy show that we do every week over at ringside. So we invited Capone to come through and Capone was there hanging out with us. And then, shortly after that, like in the middle of the comedy show, I was like, yo, Screw, I'm about to get ready to head to the hotel and just get everything packed up because our flight is like 6 o'clock in the morning. He's like, all right, cool. So as we driving, you know, we're heading over to the hotel. Capone was still there. And Screw, they still hanging out and having fun. So Capone goes out for a smoke. And as he going out there, some kid from the projects run up on Capone and had the gun to his waist and was trying to take his jewels. And Screw looked out the window and saw him getting stuck up. So Sue come out to his aid. So as Screw walked out, dude still had the gun. And Screw was like, yo, what the fuck? Like, this nigga with us. But as he was holding it in, Screw went, grabbed the gun, twisted his arm, and punched him. Knocked him out, right? But it was so much commotion going on, he didn't even realize that the gun went off as he was grabbing it. And then he made sure Capone was good. You good? Everything? Oh, yeah, good. And he took two or three steps walking to his car, and he collapsed. So when he fell, you know, that's when everybody realized, oh, shit, he been shot, you know? So that's when I got the phone call. Yo, Screw just got shot. They about to take him to the airport, to the hospital. So I made the U-turn and met them at the hospital. You know, it was down in Hoboken, down in downtown Jersey City. And then we went over to the hospital. When I got there, they had already took him into the emergency and started operating on him. And then the doctor came out like 2-3 hours later and told us that he didn't make it.
Oof.
Yeah.
How bad of a shock was that?
Yeah,
too?
No, it was crazy because Screw was one of those guys that he was one of the few people that you never thought would die. Like he was always in the face of danger, and he was always the one that walked out without a scratch.
Yeah,
and he was always the one that always kind of brought people together, or was always the one that would be the first to run when somebody was in trouble. The same way, like he died the way that he lived, you know, going in trying to protect or you know. Pretty much, you know, go to Capone's rescue, and that's when he got hit.
Sad, man. Sad.
Yeah, it is.
Sorry for your loss. Sorry for your loss with them. Well, you go and do your second album, Convicted.
Right.
Debuted at number 2. And after 7 weeks, it goes platinum And 16 weeks ago is double platinum.
Right.
So now you're just off to the races. Sophomore jinx, blah. Fuck all that.
It didn't matter.
And that had Smack That on there.
Right.
Which, you know, when you look at Spotify right now, that's your biggest song.
Right.
How did you and Eminem collaborate on that?
Oh man, that one, I went and found him. Like this, like that one was, that was just like a, whew. So M was always one of my favorite rappers back then, especially. I had just did the record with Snoop, I Wanna Love You.
Great record, by the way. I Wanna Love You is an all-time classic as well.
You know, and then I was like, man, I was able to conquer Snoop, now I gotta get M. I got to.
Right, and back then, Eminem was not doing features like that.
No, he wasn't doing features at all. Yeah. Like, literally, he wasn't doing.
I think maybe Renegade was out around that time.
Man, he was
Jay-Z,
chilling him.
But that was it.
That was it.
Yeah.
So, I that's why I said it was a shot in the dark. So I just said, let me just go to Detroit. I'm just gonna go there. So I got him, I booked a ticket and flew out there. And when I flew out there, I was out there hanging in the strip club. And I'm just asking questions like, yo, you know, where M at? Where M hang out at? Like,
oh, I saw him at the grocery store yesterday.
Right.
He's outside all the time.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Okay. So I'm asking questions like, where this nigga at? And then I run to this one nigga who just happened to be mad cool. He said, yo, I heard you looking for M. I said, yeah, I've been trying to get a hold of him, man. I ain't got no line on him right now. He said, well, shit, Obi's my man.
Obi Trice.
Yeah, Obi. I said, Obi, you shit, you got Obi shit? So he called Obi. Obi come meets me at the strip club. Me and Obi hanging out. We hang out for like 2 days. Then he said, yo, I'm gonna take you to the studio so you can go meet M. I was like, nigga, perfect. So Obi takes me to the studio. Me and M connects instantly, like instantly, right? So he playing me awesome. He playing me beats and everything. And at the time, I already had the song that I wanted to do with him already. I already had it set up. I never even got to play him that song, right? So he was playing me all these beats, and then he just pulled the beat. Doom, 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 doom. I was like, oh, shit.
Oh, so that was his beat?
Nigga, M produced that track.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yes.
Okay.
M produced that track, right? So when I heard that, I was like, oh, nigga, this shit about to be crazy. So off top, I just go in the booth and just start freestyling harmonies. By the time I get out the booth, M had already left. I was like, where the hell this nigga go? So I said, fuck it, I'm just gonna finish this song and let him hear when he get back tomorrow and he can lay his verse to it. So I laid the whole jump, come back the next day. It was about 1 p.m. By the time I got there, the song was already laid. This nigga then came in 8 o'clock that morning, laid his verse, and left for lunch. So I got there around lunch break. He hadn't already came. So by the time he got back to lunch, he came back in. He was like, yo, you want to hear it? I said, hell yeah. He plays it for me. I go crazy in that moment. Right? And I was like, nigga, where was you at? He said, nigga, I went to lunch. I said, nigga, you ain't just order food to come here? He said, nah, man, I treat this shit like a real 9 to 5. He said, I come in early, 9 to 5. I leave at 5 o'clock on the dot every day. I come in, I take a lunch break, then I come back to work, 5 o'clock, I'm home. He said, I treat this like a real job. Mm. And I thought about that shit. I was like, damn, that shit's smart.
Yeah.
Because it'll open your days up. Mm-hmm. It was through him that made me start saying, okay, I need to start scheduling it. 9 to 5 was a little too early for me, but I had my schedules. Like, I don't do late night studios anymore. I just do them during the day. And then I'm out before midnight. You know what I'm saying?
I mean, monster song.
Yeah, no, monster song.
Monster song, monster. Multi-platinum. The album eventually goes triple platinum, or is it higher than that by now?
Yeah, no, it's that, all three of my albums went diamond. All of them sold over
diamond.
All of them. Yeah. Which is cool, because my albums never really did really major big numbers the first week. I was never
It takes a while.
Yeah, I was always just consistent. I would consistently do 100,000 a week for like 3-4 years.
Well, you end up doing Sweet Escape with Gwen Stefani.
Right.
Another huge record.
Monster record.
It's like the number of hits that you have is something crazy.
No, we was on a roll around that time, because then we went from that. Then I did the Celebration with Madonna. I mean, it was crazy. We just started moving, man. Then I started doing all these classic artists, you know, from Lionel Richie to Quincy Jones, and then Michael Jackson.
Well, Michael Jackson, you end up doing a remix to Wanna Be Starting Something.
Right.
And then later on, I guess you guys started to get close.
Yeah.
So I had never met Michael Jackson.
Man, amazing.
I mean, I've interviewed, you know, Black Child. I've interviewed Dallas Austin, you know, producers that actually work closely with him.
Right.
You know, as well as, you know, Tito Jackson.
Right.
You know, his brother. What was the relationship like with Michael? And what was Michael like when the cameras aren't on?
No, Mike was amazing, dog. Like, honestly, no, that's the only thing I really regret is that the world never seen Mike like as his true self. You know what I'm saying? They always seen the choreographed Mike, like the Mike that Mike wanted you guys to see. Because he always felt the moment I walk out of there, lights, camera, action. So he created this. He choreographed everything about himself as an artist. So he was a true artistic person. And if it wasn't artistic, then he'd be walking around in a disguise. So he'd be standing next to you, you won't even know it, because he'd be in full disguise. But Mike,
I heard about this. He'll show up like in a beard.
Like, yeah.
I've interviewed people about
it. He'll show up.
Yeah, he looked like an old white man. Like, you wouldn't even know.
You won't even know.
Yeah, I guess what he did was he hooked up with the guy that did all the Thriller.
Right.
like special effects and all the, and he would have that guy create just disguises for him. Yeah, crazy. Just
different profiles. I remember one time I went to the movies together. And he had
you went to the movies with Michael Jackson.
Yeah, so Mike was the one that introduced me to the IMAX theater experience. I never knew what that shit was. So we was in Vegas and he was like, yo, you gotta see this. You gotta see this shit. It's crazy. So we go, he's in his full, you know, design and everything else. And I'm looking normal. I'm like regular and shit, right? So we get on this elevator and these group of white girls come running to the elevator. Oh my God, oh my God. And they come running in. And at this point, I'm like, oh shit, I think they recognize him. I'm not even thinking about myself, like, at all, right? And they come getting all, you know, can we take a picture, Akon? Oh my God, we love your music. So they go on to take pictures, and Mike over there just giggling. Like, he's giggling. Right?
He's taking the picture?
Right.
Photo by Michael Jackson.
Mike just giggling, laughing, like, tripping off, right? And I'm sitting here like, Mike, I promise you one more laugh, I'm gonna give you up. You better keep it quiet, right? So, Mike, we get off the elevator and we go in. So now at this point, the girls are walking kind of quiet, and then Mike see a group of more kids. He's like, hey guys, that's Akon. And I'm like, Mike, fuck, man. So all the kids just start screaming, ah! And this is when I was at my height, right? So they all start coming. So we was there for like 20 minutes, man, just taking pictures, signing autographs. And Mike there the whole time grabbing phones and taking my picture, right? Tripping, like just putting more work on me for no reason, right? So I'm in my mind, I'm like, man, if these kids only knew that Mike is like right there taking our picture. Like, can you imagine that shit?
Yeah, I actually looked it up when I interviewed Jason Weaver, who played young Michael Jackson in the Jackson movie. He said that Michael would just show up full disguise, like an old white man.
Right.
And would just be hanging, and Jason didn't know who he was. No one knew who he was.
Right.
And he would be hanging out on set.
Right.
Nah, and nobody knew. Yeah.
Amazing. But behind closed doors, no makeup, no nothing. Super funny, like cool as a fan, man.
I heard he was really masculine, you know, even, you know, because people look at him like, you know, with a high voice,
right.
They think that he's feminine and so forth, but I heard in real life, he was not like that at all.
Nah, Mike liked him.
Yeah.
He got it.
I remember
we actually had some real conversations. I got to know his type and all that. You know, he liked models, you know, tall, slim models, you know what I'm saying?
So all the, you know, the pedophile and the gay stuff that came.
And I think all that was propaganda because Mike was doing such big things in the publishing world. I always felt like the music side, he was buying out a lot of great real estate.
The Beatles catalog?
A lot of stuff, and he wouldn't sell it back or wouldn't offer no options for it to be sold. And then, of course, his own catalog, there was a big fight around that. You know, I think what Michael was more about, it was power, because he was super smart and understood what real value meant to America. So he had access to a lot of American value, and he owned it. And if he didn't own it 100%, he owned it 50%. You know what I'm saying? Like, he owned a big chunk of America's value. That's the best way to put it. And at some point, you know, they're gonna wanna have the option to buy it back or control it to an extent. Mike just wouldn't allow it. And I think at that moment, that's when a lot of the propaganda and all this whispers and stuff start coming out about him, which was clearly not true.
I bought the Beatles.
Yeah.
While I'm doing the video with the Beatles. That's gangster.
Right.
With Michael Paul, walks into Paul McCartney. You're going to sell the Beatles? How much you selling for? Oh, I don't know. You know, about $60 million. Wow, that's a lot of money. That motherfucker go right to his trailer, get his people on the phone. Paul don't find out till the next fucking day Michael done bought the Beatles. That motherfucker come on and say, how can you buy Beatles? How can you buy Beatles? He said 60. I gave you 64. That's a lot of money. The girl is mine.
Your publishing's mine.
This nigga's a gangster, nigga.
Yeah, I had interviewed this guy named Ron Newt, he had a group called the Neutrons, right. His sons, and they were signed to Joe Jackson. So right. He would be hanging out at Michael Jackson's house and he's showing me pictures and everything right. else like that. And he showed me a picture of his son wearing like tidy whitey underwear at Michael Jackson's house. And they said, yeah, they offered me $50,000 to try to say that Michael Jackson molested my son.
That's fucked up.
And I told him that if Michael Jackson molested my son, I would have killed Michael Jackson myself. He never touched my son.
1,000, man.
Michael was 100.
Mike loved kids, bro. Like, one thing about him, the reason why he loved kids so much is because he felt like he never had a childhood himself, right?
Yeah.
Because he grew up in as an adult. You know, you, as a child star, you don't get to have fun and become that child you always wanted to be. And this is why he had so many things around him, like, you know, amusement parks in his backyard, candy and stuff like that. Because he wanted kids to really enjoy being children. You know what I'm saying?
Was Bubbles, the monkey, around when you guys were hanging out?
No, he wasn't around.
Okay, because Ron New told me another story. He said that when they were over, he was over at Michael Jackson's house with all his kids.
Right.
And I guess the monkey had bit one of the kids. And he said he saw Michael Jackson beat the shit out of the monkey.
And so he had Bubbles. And I'll never forget, the kids was playing with Bubbles. So Bubba bit Jay.
Bubbles is the monkey.
Bubba bit Jay on his arm. And Jay said, Dad, he bit me. Michael said, he did what? He said, Bubba, did you bite him? He said, Michael said, bam, slapped him to his knees. And Bubba said, blah. I said, what is he doing? Michael said, praying for his life, because he know he done did the wrong thing.
So Michael Jackson beat up Bubbles.
He hit him with an eight-piece.
With an eight-piece?
With an eight-piece. Mike was fast.
Really?
Oh, my God.
But monkeys are really strong, though.
Yeah, but he couldn't mess with Mike. Mike hit him so fast, man, he was down on his knees. So Michael
just beat the crap out of Bubbles.
He hit him with an eight-piece.
Hit him with an eight-piece.
Like Mayweather hit Pacquiao.
With his bare hands. Just hit him with like a five-piece. Yeah. Rest in peace, Ron Newt. He passed about a year ago, man. Yeah. And you actually, did you do the very last song with Michael Jackson?
Bro, can you listen?
Was it Hold My Hand?
I did the very last song with Mike and did also the very last song with Whitney Houston. Ain't that crazy? That's crazy. It was kind of scary for me.
People going to be scared to do their songs with you.
I mean.
They might think it's their last song if they do something
with you. I hope
it
ain't.
Yeah, I'm joking a little bit, but.
You'd be surprised how many niggas take that shit serious, though.
Serious? Oh, you think people actually?
Man, these niggas are so ignorant today. You'd be surprised.
Well, congrats, man. The last song ever with Michael Jackson.
Yeah, that was an honor, though.
That's definitely an honor, man. And to this day, the greatest entertainer of all time. That's what Gordy said at his funeral.
I'm telling you, he is, though. I mean, to this day, I haven't seen anyone that can match or get close.
Well, then you drop your third album, Freedom.
Freedom.
That had Right Now.
Right.
Nah, nah, nah.
Yeah,
I'm So Paid with Lil Wayne and Jeezy, Beautiful. Once again, that goes multi-platinum. Diamond, I guess, eventually.
It's kind of hard to believe that my whole career, I only put out three albums. Like, right. That was crazy.
Right, because like, I was at SRC and we were all waiting for that fourth album.
Right.
Remember that?
I was waiting too.
And I was there a few years. Right. I'm like, we'll drop his album next month. Like, yeah,
right.
Cool.
I think but that was around the time when all the mergers was happening. Yeah. And
honestly, I think SRC ultimately folded because you didn't drop that fourth album.
I actually wanted to. I was ready to. But
not to say it's your fault. Yeah, I think
I was beating them up, but I think
because we weren't having, SRC didn't have any big, you know, they had artists that people liked, but it wasn't Akon status artists at the time.
For sure.
Yeah, like Melanie Fiona was over there. Asher Roth was over there.
He was the one guy that I was surprised that didn't go because he was super talented, bro.
Yeah, he was cool.
I was just shocked.
He was cool. But Akon was on a whole different level at the time. I'd read something that Nelly suggested you put together a group with you, Pharrell, and T-Pain.
Oh, actually, that was something Nelly was actually, he wanted to do it. I was down for it at the time.
It just never happened.
It just never happened.
Yeah.
I was totally cool for it.
Well, you were actually signing artists as well. You signed T-Pain.
Right.
That went out of here.
Yeah, he was gone.
From your point of view, why do you think that, you know, the way people kind of look at it is Future kind of replaced T-Pain for doing that type of thing that T-Pain did, you know, the auto-tune hooks,
right,
that type of thing. As someone who signed T-Pain, why do you think that ultimately happened? Why do you think T-Pain is not, because T-Pain is ultra talented to this
super
day.
Super talented.
Why do you think that people stop fucking with him to the same extent?
Well, I think one of the major reasons is that T-Pain never left the hood. Like, he just confined his music to urban music.
He never did house or EDM or...
That was it. Because
other international artists like you
1,000%. Because T-Pain was more... Like, I saw T-Pain as another me to be able to cross outside of urban, go into pop, go into EDM, go into his Latin. Like, that was... I still think to this day he still can do it. I would enter to the Latin side today, though, because he can definitely do it. But I think because that was the only reason. And the fact that you and I know better than anybody, urban audience aren't loyal.
Fickle.
Every year there's a new nigga, like every year. So
yeah.
you gotta take full advantage, maximize your urban presence, and then right as that new slide or side nigga coming, you exit. Give him his space. Right. Because if not, that's just how it is. And some people try so hard to hold on, but hip hop just it's a sticker and mover. It don't stick around long enough.
Yeah.
Unless you continue to reinvent yourself.
Right, because I personally think that T-Pain's more talented than Future. Personally.
I think talent is a matter of opinion.
Yeah.
You know? Honestly, I think talent is a matter of opinion. Future is super talented. Like, I think when I listen to Future, like, I've never met someone that can take a specific type of style and reinvent it every time and it still sound the same. Nigga, that shit is genius.
No, I feel you.
It's genius. Like, it's fucking genius.
Because when you hear Future, you know it's Future.
Right. Like, you know it's
right
him.
Right away. It doesn't matter who he's with or.
But if you notice too, his rhyme patterns change all the time, but voice don't.
They do. Yeah.
And his cadence don't.
Yep.
Like, I was listening to a couple of his mixtapes. I'm like, damn, this nigga actually introduced a lot of rap styles. Like, Future, like, a lot of rap styles, man. Like, between Future and Migos, I think they was the most influential when it comes to rap styles that everybody adapted.
I agree.
Honestly.
I agree. Well, then you signed Lady Gaga.
Yeah, that was...
Which was just out of here.
That was probably the biggest blessing I've had in the business. And I thank Jimmy Iovine for that, because he threw me a bone on a huge level.
She ultimately left.
Well,
right?
Yeah.
Or did the contract expire? Or
No. Actually, happened? No, it wasn't that. It was like... It was more of a business and a like... Okay, it's only but so far you could take somebody and you can't be selfish. And I took her as far as I thought I could take her. I took her as musically, as far as I thought I could take her. Mm-hmm. And at that moment, that's when Jimmy Iovine offered me to buy my stake and share in it.
Oh, so Jimmy Iovine bought out your shares of Lady Gaga.
Right. So
how many millions was that?
It was good enough to allow me to invest. You know?
In the tens of millions?
It was after that sale, I became an investor.
Was it in the tens of millions?
I'm not. It was after that sale, I became an investor.
Because she was the biggest thing in the world.
No, the biggest
thing
in the world.
Yeah.
And one thing I learned in business, you capitalize at the peak.
True.
Because I could have been selfish and try to hold on and lag on to her and say, no, I'm not letting her out of the contract, or I'm not buying or selling any of my shares. Yeah. I mean, I see this happen all the time and you see how that ends up. Mm-hmm. But she was more like my little sister, and I wanted her to expand to a beyond of where, because I know no matter how or where she goes, my legacy and her is already attached. So the value was already, to me, I already had gotten the value of it. And I really wanted her to expand, to be her own person and do what she ultimately wanted to do without no ties and attachments to me.
Yeah, and you were also on arguably her biggest record, Just Dance.
Right.
Which is what introduced her to the world on top of that. Yeah. So yeah.
The first two albums me and Red One did, which are the two biggest albums.
Yeah. It's crazy. And she ended up doing the NFL halftime show eventually,
man.
And just became an icon.
I mean, she became literally the biggest artist in the world.
She did.
Right.
She did. I guess you actually had a chance to sign Drake at one point and you passed up on him.
Oh, because Cardinal Official brought him to me back in 2005, I think it was. Mm-hmm. Right, what was it, four? It was right before the Best I Ever Had blew up. Because at the time it was like more mixtape-ish, you know? Mm-hmm. And at the time, believe it or not, Drake sounded more like Eminem.
Really?
Yeah, with that demo that I heard, he was sounding more like him. But I think that was around the time when that's every artist developing, you know? And you can see the difference between that demo and Best I Ever Had. It was completely different.
He was with Wayne by that time, right?
Huh?
Best I Ever Had.
Best I Ever Had was when everybody was after him.
Oh, so he had
signed
to get money at that
point? At that time, he hadn't quite signed. Oh, okay. He was negotiating with everybody. There was like this huge bid war.
Yeah.
And that's when Cardi was like, nigga, I told you this nigga was going to be the shit. I said, well, shit, reach out. He said, you can, but the lowest bid right now is $1 million. I said, shit, I ain't got $1 million.
Yeah, now I remember speaking to Gabby at SRC, and they had a chance to sign him also.
Yeah,
I think
no, everybody
like,
had a chance to sign him.
I Sylvia, think that they had like 500,000, and he wanted 800, and it just...
Yeah, Sylvia Rome had the biggest chance to sign her, because mm-hmm. she, but you know,
to Motown,
but at the time she had Trey Songz, and she felt like Trey was just going to be the biggest thing ever.
I think Trey tried to sign him also.
Man, everybody tried everybody to sign Drake. Everybody tried to sign him. Man, listen, bro, out of all the artists today, Drake to me, he is worth what every single fucking penny.
Oh, yeah.
Every single penny. That motherfucker's genius, bro.
Oh, yeah. He's breaking Beatles.
Yeah, he's a fucking...
You know, runs, you know, in terms of the number of hits.
Revolutionary,
and so
what he's doing.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
And he's still at his height.
Right.
He hasn't fallen off.
No, you know why? Because he's pivoting. He's not sticking to that one pocket.
Oh, yeah.
And that's the only way to do it. The moment you stop and get stuck in that one pocket, had he just stayed completely urban, forget it.
Oh, yeah. No, I remember when I talked to Kamaya... And we talked about the record that she did with YG and Drake.
Right.
And she was like, oh, Drake was already tapped in with me. YG takes that record. You're already on the hook.
Mm-hmm. I had a verse in the hook already.
Okay.
Yeah.
But he took just the hook.
Yeah.
He did his own verse.
Yeah.
Then he added Drake, uh-huh. of all people,
mm-hmm.
who even at that time was the biggest thing
mm-hmm.
in music.
Mm-hmm.
How did you find out about that record? And what was your reaction?
That was because of me anyways. Nobody know that. Like, Drake was already tapped in.
Really?
Yeah. So I was already talking to Drake before that even happened.
Really?
Yeah, YG just hit him like, I'm about to sign her. He was like, I fuck with her, I'm going to do it. Because me and him was already tapped in on our own accord.
Right. He had already been following my underground Oakland movement and was already DMing me and everything. Drake is so in tune.
Nah, I
remember hanging out with Giggs in the UK after our interview. He's like, no, Drake calls me all the time. He just loves the music.
Right.
You know, and
he get it.
He's
a music
UK
guy.
Shit. Yeah,
he's a music guy. You know, I think that's a lot of what we have in common. That's why he's such an amazing businessman too.
Well, then 2009, there was a situation that happened with Suge Knight.
Right.
And was he your road manager?
At the time, yeah, he was my road manager.
Okay. Yeah. Robert Carnes Jr.,
yeah,
who goes by
Big Ja.
Big Ja.
Right.
Now, Ja told me this story
mm-hmm.
offline.
Right.
From your point of view, what happened?
It's whatever Ja told you.
Okay. Well, let me go ahead and repeat it then.
There you go.
Okay.
Just repeat what Ja said.
You could chip in to say whether this is accurate or not.
Right.
So, allegedly, Suge Knight had approached... Now, were you there when it happened?
I was there on all four approaches.
Okay, got it.
And Ja was there for the last approach.
Okay.
Right.
So you're saying Suge approached you three other times?
Oh, yeah. Me and Suge, we was always going back and forth.
Okay.
Always.
Over what?
You know Suge.
Yeah.
Trying some producer. Some tax, trying to get the toll.
Right.
And
so
it wasn't happening.
So
it was simple.
From what I heard, there was a producer that Suge was...
Right.
Representing.
It was a kid named Detail who I signed.
Detail, exactly.
Right.
And Suge felt like you owed Detail some money.
Well, actually, it was a little bit, it was different. That wasn't quite what it was. Detail was signed to me.
Mm-hmm.
But what happened was when I signed Detail, it's unfortunate that Detail still had an agreement with Ray J.
Aha.
And at the time, Suge was in business with
Ray J.
Whatever that business was.
Okay.
So Suge came to meet me at the studio and said, listen, you know, I hear you got Detail. I said, yeah, I got him. He said, okay, well, I want to talk to you about some business, you know, that wasn't finished before you signed him. I said, what happened? He said, well, he apparently owes Ray J $25,000. I said, okay, that's no problem. If he owe him, then we get Ray paid. So I called Ray. I said, yo, Ray, you know, does Detail owe you money? Ray was like, yeah, he owed me with Con. You know, you family, it's all good. We figure it out. I said, all right, perfect, no problem. His next track or whatever we sell up into 25 will go directly to you to pay you out
mm-hmm.
until you're clean and we go. We had all agreed to it. Suge said, okay, cool, no problem. A month later, I'm in the club. Suge shows up with like three of his little homies. Yo, what's up with that money? I said, what money? He said, you know, we talked about it. I said, yeah, we did. I said, the moment he places a track, we'll pay him. And when I said we'll pay him, I was talking about paying Ray J. Mm-hmm. So he was like, well, you know, me and Ray 50-50 partners, so just give it to me and then I'll give it to Ray. I said, well, I gave Ray my word. So when that money come, I'll give it to Ray. And I said, that's your partner, he'll pay you. Mm-hmm. He said, Khan, you know how this shit go, bro. Just see me when the money come. I said, no problem, I'll call you when the money come. Second, third visit, I was in Vegas. I had a walkthrough at this club. He came through with his homeboy, and I think it was his little girlfriend at the time. So we over there, he's like, yo, Khan, what's up, man? Man, I haven't talked to you in like 3 weeks, bro. Where we at with the business? Just at this time, he's drunk. Like, I can tell he's kind of tipsy. You know, so he's like, yo, man, you know, where that money at? I said, well, goddamn, Sugar, you broke? You need some money or something?
And this is over $12,500.
50% of 2,500. Right. I mean, 25,000.
Yeah.
I said, what's up? You broke or something? He said, nah, nigga, never that. Nigga, you know me, nigga. I done made hundreds of millions, nigga. Yeah. It's about the principle, bro. It's about the principle. I said, okay, the principle is we spoke, we had an agreement, and I'm going to honor that agreement when the money comes. I said, if you're trying to get the money before the money comes, that's a different conversation. Because you keep pulling up on me and shit. Like, what is it? He said, well, man, you know how this shit go. Nigga, this is the West Side, man. You know, we can't wait 90 days for our money. I said, okay. I'll try to speed it up and see if they're going to shoot the money earlier. Cool. We good. Then he calls me the next morning. Yo, man, you know, I was a little tipsy, bro. I apologize. You felt some kind of way, man. You know, I ain't really mean it like that. You know, but don't worry about it, man. Let's just get it going. Whenever you get it, just call me. We good, right? We straight? I said, yeah, we straight, big dog. Good looking out. So at this point, me and him always had a communication. Every time he called me, I would always respond. And then I called Detail. I said, yo, Detail, listen. Sugar been pulling up on me a little bit about this little money. How you looking with these records? Because I need to go ahead and get some of these joints placed so he can stop asking. He said, don't worry about it. I got it. I'm in the lab. I'm cooking every day. I said, no problem. So now, that following week, Super Bowl in Arizona. I'm already in Vegas because I was already there from the week before. So we left from there to go, you know, to the Super Bowl. I'm throwing this huge party at the W. We up there, it's me, Ja, 2T's, Big D. These are all my guys. And we party having a great time. Sugar comes with his homie, his girlfriend, and I think it was one other person. And at the time, my security got my section roped off. He's trying to get in, they won't let him in. So he like, yo. So I like, yeah, come on in. He good. He walks over, yo, Khan, we good? I said, yeah, we good, nigga. What y'all want to drink? Whatever, just, you know, help yourself, nigga, you fam. He said, no, with that, I'm talking about with the money. I said, God damn, Shug, really?
12,500.
Nigga, we partying. We can't talk about this shit tomorrow. Nah, nigga, we need to talk about this right now, man. I ain't got time. I'm about to head back out to L.A. I said, all right, well, cool. When you get to L.A., call me. We'll talk about it then. So now at this point, 2T's is looking at his homie. He can see that his homie packing something because he can see the dent right there, right? So, and Ja is looking directly at Suge at this point. He see, okay, this nigga raising his voice because the music playing so loud. So now we like this. I'm standing on top of the couch. I'm like about this high over him. So I got him by his neck talking to him as we're talking. So, and I'm saying to him, nigga, don't worry about it. When we get to L.A. tomorrow, just call me. And then when I get to L.A., you know, we meet up and we'll figure it out. Right? Because at this time, my mind, I'm like, you know what? This nigga probably really needs some money. So when I get to L.A., I give him a little something to hold him until whatever. So I'm already in my mind like, you know what? I'm going to look out. You know what I'm saying? So he's insisting that he gets the money then. So then when I said, nah, it's not going to happen tonight, that's when he popped up. Was like, nigga, all right. It's on and popping in, my nigga. He said something about I have to pay a toll when I come to L.A. and that my mom won't be able to come to L.A. And then that's all I can tell you from that point forward. The rest is...
Well, the story I heard, which is very similar to your story.
Right.
From Ja's point of view, He's probably going to be mad at me for sharing the story. But
well, if he shared it with you, then it's cool.
It is what it is.
I'd rather come from your mouth than mine.
He basically said that Suge approached you guys about some money that was owed. Ja got involved in the conversation at one point. Mm-hmm. You know, Suge said he wanted his money right then and there. And Ja's like, yo, we're going to pay you, but through the proper means. Mm-hmm. But if you want to get hostile like this, we can go to the bathroom and we can fight.
Right.
And Ja is a big, is about probably bigger than Suge.
No, they're about the same size.
About the same size, but very, actually, very
so
stocky.
Suge is actually a little bit bigger than Ja, actually.
Okay.
Yeah.
Ja's probably not as tall, but he's a bit wider.
Yeah, no, they're both stocky.
They're both huge, mm-hmm. right? So Ja said, yo, we can go to the bathroom if you can fight, we can fight if that's what you want to do. And he said, at that point, Suge was like, motherfucker, I don't fight. I'll have your mother killed. You know, I'll have your whole family killed. I'll have... And Ja said he just had enough at that point. He said he just, the mouthing off and the threats and all that. He said Ja just reached his breaking point. Ja, I guess, apparently was involved with John Gotti Jr.'s crew mm-hmm. back in the day.
Yeah, that was his defendant.
Yeah,
co-defendant.
So he had already had some charges and some prison time and all that.
Well, it was a lot going on, and it was a lot of, everybody was kind of tipsy except me, because I'm completely sober all the time, so I clearly saw everything that happened. The first punch came from 2T's to his homie.
Okay.
Because at the moment when I grabbed him by the neck and started talking to him, the homie looked like he was about to pull.
Yeah.
And that's when 2T's hooked off on him. Homie fell, and the gun fell to the floor with it.
Mm.
And at that moment, that's when Ja hooked off on Suge.
And knocked him out.
And Suge fell down in slow motion.
Yeah.
And that's when Big D grabbed me and the gun that was on the floor and took me to my room.
Right. And then according to Ja, security ran in and started tasing him.
And then this club security, when they came, I was already out the back door.
Right. And then from what I heard was that Suge actually pressed charges against Ja.
No. Suge did more than press charges.
He sued.
He did more than sue.
What did he do?
He did what everybody mad at 6ix9ine about.
He told.
I'm just saying. He did what everybody mad at 6ix9ine about.
And from what Ja told me, that he actually had to pay Suge off a significant amount of money.
To drop the charges.
To drop the charges.
I had to pay Suge off to drop the charges for Ja. Because I couldn't see my man going to jail for that shit.
Yeah, because he was. I guess Ja was facing a bunch of years over that. An assault charge, essentially.
Because Ja was after having, Ja had just got out.
He was after having a bunch of priors and everything else like that. And was that pretty much the split between you and Ja after that?
Nah, me and Ja never really split. Me and Ja never split. It just, when that happened at that moment, mm-hmm. we had to kind of show a little bit of distance because of all the shit that was going on. And I felt it was more for Ja's protection, even though I don't think he needed protection. But normally when somebody get knocked out, they don't come back with fists. They come back on the blaze. Mm-hmm. And I know as long as Ja was close to me, he could be a target because of that.
Mm.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely.
So that's all it really was. And then as that time started going on, then the music obviously slowly slowed down. I wasn't on the road as much. And then just time just kind of, and the merge happened that gave us that 2-3 years break from the music business. And that's all it was. And then with that, I just started to grow and become larger than business and music. Mm-hmm. And I just started doing bigger things on this level. And Ja at that time had found other artists that he was trying to break on the music scene. Yeah, so it just naturally kind of metamorphed into some other stuff, but it wasn't like, we never had no split up or nothing like that.
Yeah, I think he ended up managing Chantel.
Yeah, right, SRC. Chantel and stuff
yeah,
like
and
that.
And I think some other people as
right.
well.
And me, I wasn't even thinking about no music. I was on my lighting projects and stuff like that around that time.
Well, according to Forbes, like around this time, well, later on, a few years later, they're saying that you grossed $13 million in 2011, $21 million in 2010, $20 million in 2009, $12 million in 2008. Mm-hmm. You were just bringing in tens of millions every year.
Man, I don't even know what I bring. I never report anything to Forbes.
They just come up with those numbers?
I don't know, unless my business managers just gave me some numbers.
Yeah, most people don't really want to be on the Forbes list. Like,
man, listen.
That type of spotlight.
Mm-mm. And if you do, you want to always be under the 15 million mark, no matter how much money you make.
Mm. Why is that? Why is 15 million the magic number?
Under.
Why?
It's easier to manage when you're dealing with the government.
Aha. Okay. Yeah. 2010, you end up doing Kush.
Right.
With Dr. Dre and Snoop Dogg.
That was an honor working with them two together.
Which was supposed to be the lead single for Detox.
Right.
Which is never coming out.
I mean, nigga's so rich. I mean, but at this point, like, honestly, if he does it, it should be just as a hobby, just something for the passion and the love.
Yeah.
But, you know, Dre is a perfectionist in everything he does. And I think he always was afraid to somehow feel like he wouldn't accomplish what he think he should or what the world anticipates.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
but I don't think he understands his power sometimes. I don't think he understands that. I think he's gonna win no matter what. Because just he's Dre. Like, just drop that bitch. Like, he got bangers though. Like,
I heard.
Because I know for a fact I did a couple of bangers that the world probably would never hear. But man, from what I did here when we were working together and I was submitting records for him, man, they got so much heat. But he's just a perfectionist. Like,
yeah.
Too perfect.
No, I mean, you got The Chronic, you got 2001.
Right.
You know, the Compton soundtrack was okay.
Right.
I think that was
a test to see how the world was gonna proceed.
And since it didn't blow up, it's like, Detox is done.
I think honestly, had he followed up with Detox, to me that was the perfect marketing tool for Detox.
Yeah.
I honestly believe had he followed up with Detox on that one, he would have killed him.
And then at one point you actually signed Jeffree Star.
Right.
Who's still a very big figure. Oh, yeah.
We realized with Jeffree that music wasn't really his calling. It was makeup. So now he got the biggest.
You told me about him early. Right. I remember. You're like, yo, I got this transgender dude named Sydney Star, and he's going to be the biggest thing ever. And I'm like, all right, man, I'm rocking with you.
Yeah, Jeffree killed him.
But Jeffree ended up doing makeup.
And he's doing over $50 million a year on that cosmetic line. Killing him. Jeffree killing him.
Well, 2014, you start the Lighting Africa project.
Right.
And we had a whole interview about this, how you basically, the story started when your grandmother in Senegal didn't have electricity. You try to get electricity for a house. You realize you couldn't run power lines. So then you did a deal with the Chinese government for solar panels.
Right.
Since that interview, how many Africans have electricity now, thanks to you?
Oh, man. I couldn't even estimate amounts, but we're literally in 16 countries now. And Africa got, man, I couldn't even tell you, bro. But we're probably close to about 350, maybe 400 million people with electricity now.
Half a billion people have electricity.
Yeah.
Thanks to you. Do you ever just like sit back and say, God damn, man. Let me tell you something.
I never did before COVID. COVID kind of made me understand and realize how much impact I made in that time I was working. Because normally when you're working, you're just in tunnel vision. You don't even see what's going on and what you're accomplishing. You know?
Because I don't care how smart you are when you're born. Right. I don't care how intelligent, how analytic you are. If you don't have electricity, you're just going to be doing farm work.
Period.
You can't do nothing.
What
can you do without electricity?
Absolutely.
You can't even learn outside of whatever tattered books are in your village.
Right.
You can't go on the internet.
None.
You can't Google anything. You can't look up something on YouTube.
Right.
You can't do nothing.
You can't do
jack. I remember thinking the other day, like before Google, if two people were arguing about a fact, whoever could argue better would be the winner of that argument.
Right.
You couldn't say, well, let me look it up.
Right.
Whoever had
the best argument.
The best argument would win. That would become the fact.
Now you could pull up stats.
You could pull it up.
You can Google it up and get real intel.
And just think about outside of the individuals who have electricity, think about the companies that were started and the people that were now employed in these companies.
Yeah.
One of the things that John Sally told me, which was interesting, and you might have an interesting perspective on this, because you do business with China, right? Because they gave you $1 billion loan
for
these solar panels.
Yeah.
He feels that China has been quietly buying up Africa over the years.
I keep going to China every year. China keeps going to Africa. I said, what am I doing?
You know what I'd heard? I don't know if this is true or not, but a Chinese close associate of mine told me about this. They're saying that the Chinese have been systematically giving loans to these African countries, which they ultimately can't pay back. And they're taking more and more land in different parts of Africa from these loans. And they're slowly starting to take over Africa.
They're buying Africa.
buying Africa, essentially. That's true?
That's very true. Mm.
Is that true?
I wouldn't say buying up. China's been... See, the thing is, China is such has such a huge economy that China itself is not big enough for the economy that they built for them. And they need a place or a partner to expand that economy because China alone can't do it. Hmm. And their relations with U.S., as you can see, is a lot. It's getting worse and worse every day.
Yeah.
So even in the U.S., clearly is nowhere near big enough. So they needed either India or Africa to create that partnership. The reason why Africa became the biggest concentrated market for China is because we share the same cultures. When you look at history, you look at the way we live, the way we raise our children, a lot of it is very, very similar. So they can really relate to the culture in Africa. And then 35 years ago, China was in the same exact position that Africa was today.
Hmm.
Yeah, which is really deep. But they created a system that allowed them to figure out a way to move it in. So now China has all these factories, all this product. They can't keep all of that shit stored up in what's names, but they also need to expand that audience too, as far as who all this product is going to. So Africa can utilize majority, at least 90% of the stuff that's being created in China today because of that culture, collaboration, you know? So what China's doing, they're creating, instead of buying, they're just bartering. They're saying, okay, listen, to keep our factories running, to keep this and that going, we need resources from Africa. We can't live without the resources. But in return, we want to be able to build infrastructure, you know, schools, roundabouts, bridges, and things of this nature. So that serves two purposes for Africa and for China, mainly. One, it gives China the distribution routes that they need to be able to create, you know, opportunity to sell more goods, distribute more goods, ship out more goods to a brand new audience.
Mm-hmm.
And two, it gives Africans the infrastructure that they need to be able to just set up a basic economy to gain enough revenue to even be able to afford that stuff. So it's a win-win situation when you look at it.
Right. But then on the flip side, you see situations like what happened with COVID where Africans start getting blamed for spreading it. Africans aren't allowed at McDonald's. Africans are getting kicked out of hotel rooms. You know?
I think
does that turn your stomach when you see stuff like that?
Not really, because I think the internet has a way of exploding certain things and make it look way bigger than it naturally is. It's no different from the Starbucks situation with them saying that they're prejudiced because a worker in there didn't want to serve coffee to a black person before a white person. And then they just get all of Starbucks now is tainted with that same comment, right?
Okay.
So I think in China it was similar because one or two incidents like that, I don't think can override as much good that China's done in Africa as a whole.
Okay.
And China's done more in Africa than anywhere. I don't care, you could say UK, America, Germany, British, I don't care who you call. No one's done more work in China to benefit Africans than the Chinese.
Yeah, and I remember John Sally even said that when you go to China and you watch TV, that Africa is actually being shown in a very positive light.
100%.
In the same way that Americans think that Africa is just a bunch of zebras running around and stuff like that, Africans are being shown as as good people and places where you'd want to live.
I go to China, I'm treated like royalty when I'm out there. Like I've never had any bad treatment. It's always been respect. You know, they in China, this is different how they treat people.
Yeah.
So that's why when I see things like that, I know a lot of that is sometimes propaganda. And because China has so much advantages in Africa and has so much control from a standpoint of relationship there, a lot of countries are getting very jealous of China being so forward in Africa that these things are created to start destabilizing the relationship between Africa and China.
Aha.
That's what I feel.
So you rock with China.
1,000%.
1,000%.
100%. I rock with China.
So then comes Akon City.
Right. That's the future.
Okay. So
Vlad, that shit.
Let me try to get my head around this. So did this come before or after Black Panther?
That actually came before Black Panther.
Okay.
But it wasn't promoted Black Panther-ish until after Black Panther.
Right. Because you're trying to call it a real life Wakanda.
Well,
did you call it that or someone else said that?
Yeah, the media ran with that.
Okay, media ran with that.
I did admire the Black Panther movie, and I did say that Black Panther is a look of what Africa's future can look like. I did say that publicly, and I think after that, they kind of ran with that.
So, from what I understand, the president of Senegal gave you 3 square miles of land.
Well, this is the thing. I had to actually buy the land.
Okay.
So it wasn't gifted to me. But what the president and the government are doing, they're actually laying the foundation for all the infrastructure on the land, like the basic sewage, electricity, you know, things like that. All the things that have to be set forth for me to build the city on top of.
Okay.
And they give me 100% full, you know, support.
Right. So it's going to include roads, a hospital.
Right.
Houses.
Right.
Hotels.
Hotels, yeah.
A police station.
Yeah.
A waste facility.
Yeah.
A school. And a solar power plant, of course.
Solar power plants, theme parks.
Theme parks.
All that, man. Boat docks.
And it's called Akon City.
It's the Akon City, yeah. That's phase one, though.
How crazy is that? You were, you know, raised in this country.
Right.
And now you're going to have your own city. You're not going to be the president or the mayor. You're going to have a city named after you. Does that just blow your mind when you think about that?
You know what? There used to be moments and times where I thought that was impossible, but that was before I used to go to Africa. When I was here in America, I couldn't even think that big. It's impossible because something like that couldn't ever happen.
You can't have Akon City in the U.S.
There's no way.
No.
There's just no way. So, but there, I could do that. Like the same way I couldn't have a utility company in America. Just imagine me living in Atlanta and trying to start my own utility company. Georgia Power would shut me down like this. Yeah. The government would shut me down like this. There's no way.
But out there.
Out there, it's open.
Right. And the whole thing is going to be run off Akon.
That's well,
the cryptocurrency.
Yeah, the cryptocurrency, Akon. You could say the city's financial infrastructure would be built off the Akon platform.
Yeah, I mean, I've publicly said I'm not a big fan of cryptocurrency myself. I've never invested in it. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm a stock guy.
That's the thing. A lot of people think that cryptocurrency is something to invest in. That's where you go wrong. That's like investing in the American dollar. You don't
invest in
the dollar.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You use a dollar to invest. You know what I'm saying? So. And I think when people start to understand money itself, they understand the value of what cryptocurrency is to tomorrow's future. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So Akon City with Akon being the currency.
Right.
Why not use the Senegalese? What's the Senegalese currency called?
CFI? CFA? No, never. I would never use that.
Why is that?
Because it's owned by the French.
Ah, so this is how you're getting around that whole colonial.
Right. I don't want the French owning the city. How about when you go into my city, you're going to have to exchange your CFA for currency.
For A-coins.
That's the only way you can spend it. The CFA won't be no good in the city.
And when are they saying this is going to actually launch?
We actually start construction in January. We start construction in January.
Okay, I guess so it was a $6 billion construction.
Yes, a $6 billion project. Damn. Phase one starts in January. And it's a 3-year bill for phase one and phase two, 5 years.
So in 18 years total?
No, 10 years total. The full city will be completely finished.
So by 2030?
Oh, by 2030, we'd be building phase 4 and 5.
Okay, so when can I go visit Akon City?
You will be able to go visit Akon City by 2026. Like literally live in it.
Wow.
You can visit before then because the city will be open by 2024.
That's so crazy.
The city will be open by that time.
I can't even put my head around it. Honestly.
But you can actually-
I mean, Vlad City, as I say it out loud, I can't even picture doing something like that.
No, but I'm telling you, go to Africa, you better think about it.
Okay.
And it'll actually be possible.
Yeah, because I guess you bought thousands of acres of land in Africa?
Right, yeah, 2,000 acres.
2,000 acres mm-hmm. in Senegal?
In Senegal. I had bought 2,000 acres to start. And then when I thought about building the city, that's when I went to go see the government. And they had areas like opportunity zones that they already had set aside. And when I saw this one specific one, I can say the government gifted it to me because they it could have definitely went to what they agenda wanted it to be. But they was like, you know what? We love your idea, we're behind you. That land is yours to do what you see, please. Just show us the proof, show us the proof of finance, show us the actual master plan of the city, and then we'll gift it to you and you can go.
I mean, how big of a team of people do you need to pull off a new city?
It's getting bigger and bigger every day. Like
thousands
right now,
of people?
No, it won't take thousands of people, but it will take hundreds.
Okay.
You know, but to start, I got a team of 15 people, one on the infrastructure side, one on the feasibility studies, one doing agriculture, one doing infrastructure, medical research, digital research, I mean, financial research. You got, it's all kind of teams. And then when you start talking about the financial aspect of how everything is going to get paid for, the companies and vendors that's going to be sitting on the land, their leasing agreements, what their concepts are to make sure it's not taxed or even not in common with other people that's there to keep the city sustainable in different ways. It's just a lot of strategic decisions to be made with certain people.
You know? Well, it's located in Senegal.
In the heart of Senegal, right by the new international airport.
So does the president preside over that particular city, or is it sovereign?
The president is always going to reside over anything in Senegal.
Okay, that's what I'm saying. Right. So it's not like it's a different country.
Well, the goal is for it to be an opportunity-free zone where you don't pay taxes.
You don't pay taxes.
Right. I want to make it to where
Senegal
you don't pay taxes.
Agreed to this.
That's what we're negotiating now.
Okay.
But it's going to happen. It's going to happen because we need an opportunity zone now. We need a free zone if you want to invest, if you want to attract investors. They want to be able to park their money like how could they do it in Bahamas or in Seychelles and
Dubai
places like that.
Or whatever, yeah.
Right. You know, because you want them to be able to know that their money is going to be secure and they can actually put their monies into something into the country that's going to actually be taxable.
And
you follow
what
I'm saying?
And is the police force still going to be able to enforce laws?
Oh, yeah.
In your city?
Yep. They'll be able to enforce laws. But we're going to have, obviously, an independent police force there that works. Like, we're going to have our own infrastructure all the way around the board. Our own fire departments, own police stations,
yeah.
Own everything.
That's so crazy.
But it'll work in conjunction with the government, though.
No, man. I mean, the guy that I met 15 years ago has his own city. Like, it's just like if someone would have told me that, yeah, that guy's doing the hook to Baby Bash right now.
Right.
He's going to have his own city one day.
No, but when you think about it, it's just real estate. When you really, if you dumb it all the way down,
yeah.
It's just real estate. Because right now, you can go buy 2,000 acres and just build your own city, really.
Yeah.
I mean, shit, Kanye just bought a big old plot of land. He planned to build his own city, too.
Yeah, but he's not going to have his own police station. He's not going to have his own fire
department.
If you
do it in America, he's not.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
I told him straight up, I said, bro, if you want to maximize on your city, and it could be something of generational wealth that you can control for the rest of your life and your family bloodline can benefit from, it needs to be in Africa. 1,000%.
Yeah, I mean, that's why I'm looking at land in Atlanta right now, just so I can have a family, multi-generational kind of estate. Weren't you talking about running for president at one point?
I was, actually. I thought about it.
It's a 2000.
Yeah. But then 16? I also thought about it, too. You know, I think right now it's so much that I want to do, and it's so African-based. And I always felt even if I did run for president, it would be for the benefit to grow Africa. As the American president, I can do some things and create partnerships in Africa to create certain protections and certain advantages for Africa. So I felt like I was doing it all for the wrong reasons.
Hmm.
And then I also felt that I'm a little young right now to run. And me being an entertainer coming out of this entertainment realm, there's so many things that I'm gonna wanna do that I'm not gonna be able to do when I'm president. And I don't know if I'm ready to lock myself down like that yet.
Right, because remember Wyclef tried to run for president of Haiti.
Yeah, but.
And that was a disaster.
Well, they tried to assassinate Clef. But
me and Praz talked about that.
Right.
Because Praz was actually endorsing the guy that was running against Clef.
We're like, come on, Praz. Like, you see what I'm saying? Like, yeah, come on. Like, how you gonna do that, Praz?
Right.
You know, but I mean, it goes, you know, Clef has actually the mental to do it. Like, he's super smart. And he could,
of course.
I think he honestly, because of the way his patriotism is and what he's accomplished as an entertainer. If you gave him the shot to be the president, I think he could accomplish a lot there. I just think he jumped into it too quick without understanding how politics work in Haiti.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's a little more to it. And that's what I said to myself. Let me not make the same mistake. Let me understand how politics is ran in America. Understand how politics, you know, creates, you know, that overall, you could say, definition to what my legacy needs to be.
Mm-hmm.
And then let me just take my time and not rush into it because I just feel like I'm angry or I'm emotional that we're not being led properly. I'm going to run for president and then lose my opportunity to become president because I just jumped the gun. You know what I'm saying?
I mean, I'd vote for you over Kanye any day of the week, man.
But you know what? I kind of like the fact that Kanye is going to run if he decides to follow through with it. He should follow through, though. I honestly think he should follow through. Because Kanye's a lot smarter than y'all think, man.
Yeah, he's also,
but I would prefer
he's also mentally unstable, though.
I would prefer Kanye than Trump.
No, I wouldn't.
You don't think?
Well,
so let me ask you.
I actually don't want either one of them, honestly.
But I mean,
to be
if you
honest.
Had to choose between Kanye and Trump right now. To me, that's,
that's such a horrible set of choices.
But I'm just saying, do you think, honestly, that Trump is mentally stable?
No, not exactly. But I also know that Kanye's bipolar. I mean, Kanye quit his own tour on stage. His own tour. Said, I quit. But walked away from his own international tour.
The difference between the presidency is that there's a whole bunch of people there that you can't just make a decision and it happens. See, where
Kanye,
Trump,
if Kanye ran for Trump, president, I can see Kanye just quitting like 3 months in.
But cool, I'll be
and
his
whoever
vice
the vice president,
president
is,
I'll be his vice president. Let him run, I'll be his vice president.
You'll be his vice president?
Right.
If you were the vice president, I might vote for Kanye because I know that you do an okay job once he quits.
It's conversation, it's understanding. But more than anything, I think with Trump understood the American people better than anybody. He's not dumb and he's definitely not bipolar. But he is a little bit mentally unstable in certain things. Now, decisions that he make may be completely confusing to us, but he knows exactly what he's doing. And what he's mastered the art of is business. And what's the first thing you do in business? You intimidate all your business rivals or anyone that could be, you can say, opposition to you in business. So he just took that same method and brought it to politics. All of his rivals, oppositions, he either scared the hell out of them to ride with him or got rid of them. So now you're left with only the people that scared the hell out of you and won't ever say no to whatever you say.
Right.
And then what made it even better, they put the cards on his side. He has the majority vote. So all he has to do is say, I'm doing it. And then all the Republicans are going to follow suit.
Yeah, all Congress and it passes. And the Senate. Yeah.
Well, and that's how he was able to take over.
For now.
But I'm telling you, reversing that is going to be tough, man. Because Obama had did so much good. I mean, all the way down to reconnecting us with Cuba, you know, apologizing to the Japanese for that crazy ass, you know, Hiroshima bombing. Like, he kind of brought people together. Even the Middle East that looked at Americans like, you know, really crazy with the terrorists and all that. He kind of jailed us all back together. So he had made it really comfortable for U.S. passports to be proud to be held when you travel. Now you got a U.S. passport, they won't even let you enter.
Yeah. You also own a diamond business in Africa.
Yeah.
You said that the diamond business is worse than the drug business.
Way worse. That shit ain't no joke.
Explain.
Nigga, you think they gangster down here? Man, try managing a diamond mine in Africa.
How big is this mine?
Well, I don't have it no more. I sold my stakes out of it.
Oh,
I
stole like, my stakes. Yeah, too.
I was like, no, I can't do this.
Right, because you talked about conflict diamonds and blood diamonds.
And then what I represent just didn't match what that was. To me, the diamond business was just about the money. Mm-hmm. And I realized that what I'm trying to accomplish can't be about money no more. And then when I start to realize how those kids and workers were being treated at the same mine that I own stake in, I just couldn't do it all.
Yeah.
And then a lot of those mines were actually being fueled to create wars in certain territories and things like that. So it wasn't a good thing. And then all money ain't good money.
No, facts.
Yeah.
Well, there hasn't been a fourth album yet. And I remember reading that there was going to be like a five-part album or a four-part album.
Yeah,
that was it.
So,
genres.
But just to give you, just to let you know, I just dropped the fourth album on Friday.
So the new album's out.
It's called Ain't No Peace. And this one is actually more socially driven. So this album is based on, trust me, if you ain't heard a record that spoke to you from a standpoint of substance, this record is going to be the one to do it.
Okay. I'm looking, well, is it an album or like an EP?
It's seven songs on there.
More like an EP.
It's an album.
Okay.
Today's day. See, back when I was coming up, you had to have at least 12 songs for it to be an album.
Yep.
Today, attention span is this small. So I'm gonna give you just enough.
Right, Rick Ross is on it. OG Boo Dirty, who we interviewed last time.
Yeah,
OG. Who's falling asleep. Right.
You know, Africa has to offer what the situation's come from. So this is why I concentrate a lot of my business even in Africa, because I want them to see the success that OG was so
He was literally falling asleep in the interview. Lit. I was like, I was gonna stop the interview and say something, but I'm like,
no, what it was? Because you understand, like, sometimes when an artist get an opportunity, they don't understand how much work is put into it.
Yeah.
And me and OG was going hard for 3 weeks before we saw you. Every day, nonstop, get on the plane, early morning. We had at least maybe 20 to 30 interviews a day. Mm. Literally every hour we was popping up at somebody's spot. And he wouldn't go to sleep till like 12, 1 o'clock and had to get back up at 6 a.m. Mm-hmm. So I was like, nigga, this is what it's going to take. Yeah. This is what it is. You think this shit is easy? This ain't no joke.
Yeah.
You know?
Molly Music.
But he stuck with me, though.
Yeah.
He stuck with me.
And he's on the album.
Yeah.
Molly Music is on it as well.
Yep, that's another one
but
of mine.
I just kind of feel like there's so much else going on in your life because you also own a big label in Africa.
Yeah. But I've consolidated.
Wizkid and all these guys are all signed
I've
to you.
I've consolidated everything now to Convict Culture. So everything is on Convict Culture now.
Right.
Just to make it simpler. Because before I would have Con Live, then I got Convict Music, then I got Convict Culture, then I got Convict Cartel. It was just so much going mm-hmm. on because I was trying to partition every genre for its own thing. Then we had Akonic Music Group. It was just so much.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So I said, you know what? Let me just consolidate everything to Convict Culture. That way everything can flow through it. It's a big culture. It's all coming from the grassroots of Convict in the first place. And it just made a lot of more sense. You know what I'm saying? So
yeah.
Even the Latin label, KLOK, everything, Convict Culture.
Well, but you have so many other businesses now between, right. You know, number one, your massive catalog that's right. still generating royalties to this day, to, you know, all the African, you know, Akon City, the Lighting Africa project, the label, you know, the music label in Africa, everything else like that. It seems like with music, it's almost like a fun thing. You're not really.
Yeah, it's a hobby.
It's really like a hobby.
You know what's there crazy? Like, I think it was after the Freedom album, music became more philanthropy. Mm. It wasn't about like trying to get a number one spot or outdo everybody. It was about giving people opportunities at that point. And I know it was a point where you ain't never even seen me do collaboration with known acts anymore. I was doing with all unknown acts just to give them the spotlight and the shine.
Yeah, and it's got a picture of the American flag upside down.
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. This album, it's serious, Vlad. If you haven't heard it, you might want to take a listen.
I'll listen to it right after this.
I took it back to my first album. That's the vibe.
Yeah. You
know, back to the real substance. Talk about things that everybody's dealing with right now, going through. And more anything, stalking from the eyes and the life of someone that's in the street.
Well, Akon, man, like I said in the beginning, 15 years now, right. You and I have 15, been running into each other.
That's
you know,
crazy.
And it's always like, whenever I see you, it's that same Akon that I met 15 years ago.
Nah,
it's always like, oh, Vlad, yo, let's go aside and let's chop it up for a half right. hour and let's catch up.
1,000%.
There's never been a superstar, I'm too busy mentality. Nah. You've never changed as a human being.
Yeah,
same humble dude that I first met in that studio with Baby Bash.
Right.
When I was just a mixtape DJ way before VladTV was even a consideration.
Right.
You know, and all these years later, man, you've just elevated every year. You've done great things. You've surpassed what I feel is your own expectations. I don't think you were thinking about Akon City.
No, I wasn't.
You know, when we first met or Lighting Africa.
I promise you.
Or any of that. And like I said, when we're all gone and when we're all remembered hundreds of years from now, oh yeah, there's a guy, he did music, but look what he really did.
Right.
He transformed the continent of Africa. People like to call Africa like it's a country, but the continent of Africa with the dozens of countries that it consists of, he transformed the lives of people that look like him.
Right.
You know, and something that no one else was willing to do. And he built his own city. And, you know, he created labels and gave people opportunities and everything else like that, man. It's always such an honor when you and I speak.
Nah, for sure.
You know, and I'm so, as someone who I consider my friend.
Right.
It just always brings like joy whenever I see these articles and I see these headlines, man. And, oh man, I just wish all the best for you in the future.
Nah, same for you too, bro.
No doubt.
Absolutely.
Until next time.
My guy.
Peace.